Deputy Jim Hume's not in the chamber. Question 10 has been withdrawn. A satisfactory explanation on Mr Doris's behalf has been provided, and we therefore move to the next item of business, which that concludes question time. And the next item of business is debate on motion number 14942 in the name of David Stewart on Keep CalMac Public. I'd invite members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. But before we start the debate, members will be aware that legal proceedings are ongoing in relation to the procurement process for the awarding of the Northern Isles Ferry Service contract. The case is therefore sub judice for the purposes of standing orders. I therefore advise members to refrain from referring to this procurement process during today's debate. I now call on David Stewart to speak to and move the motion. Mr Stewart, you have 14 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And could I start by moving the motion in my name? Presiding Officer, as a lifelong trade unionist, I warmly welcome to the gallery this afternoon officials and members representing CalMac and beyond. I would ask all members to congratulate them on their outstanding campaign to fight for jobs and services for CalMac. Presiding Officer, if anyone was in any doubt about the insidious trade union bill which is weaving its way through Westminster, I say to them, come to the Scottish Parliament today and see in action trade unionism at its best. Dedicated men and women, steeped in their community, committed to retaining top quality public sector jobs and services. Presiding Officer, I also want to thank the local and national media for their positive coverage of our campaigns, particularly the Daily Record, who have been four square behind the crusade to keep CalMac and carry on. Presiding Officer, a few years ago, I was in Holiday in Skye, having lunch in a cafe in Portree and reading a local community paper. There was a story about Caledonian Brains, usually called CalMac, a publicly owned ferry company that's become an institution wedded into the Scottish psyche, as identifiable as Stornoway Black Pudding, Walker's Shortbread and Barr's Iron Brew. The story in the paper mentioned a poem that local children made up that went as follows. Unto the Lord belongs the earth and all that it contains, except the Kyles and the Western Isles, for they are all McBrains. Presiding Officer, CalMac was formed on New Year's Day in 1973 as the amalgamation of two companies, the Caledonian Steam Packet Company and David McBrain Limited, whose joint histories go back two centuries. Even the names of the CalMac fleet evoke images of the rich tapestry of Scotland's past. It's almost like the vessels themselves project a personality and character of their own. Lough Seaforth, Flanlagan, Isle of Lewis, a West Coast extended family, part of the DNA of the Highlands and Islands. But the very survival of CalMac is at risk. CalMac is currently engaged in a head-to-head competition with the Serco International Facilities Company for the Scottish Government contract for ferry services on Lifeline, Clyde and Hebrides routes. Loss of that contract would effectively mean the end of CalMac. Vessels to Serco, staff to Serco, routes to Serco, and without the Clyde and Hebrides routes, CalMac would disappear. There would be no public ferry service to challenge Serco in the future. It's good, not present, I'll take you later. Including the Lifeline public services, along with those to the Northern Isles, well and truly in public hands. But let's not forget, Presiding Officer, that CalMac have run the Clyde and Hebrides ferry routes at a profit in every year of the current extended contract. Around £8.42 million has been paid back to Scottish Government in dividends or subsidy clawback since 2008-09. If the contract is lost to Serco, all dividends will be taken out of the Scottish ferry industry and sail straight into the pockets of Serco's international portfolio of private shareholders. And remember, Presiding Officer, this is Serco we are talking about, the same Serco who were banned from tendering for public contracts by the UK government over their disastrous handling of the electronic tagging contract when they were caught charging for the electronic tagging of prisoners who were dead. The idea we should trust Serco to operate these lifeline public services is deluded, dangerous and absurd. Not presently. As the West Highland Free Press said, and I quote, Serco is not a shipping company. It's a multifaceted specialist in outsourcing, which seeks to exploit the easy profits from privatised government services. And we know how the model works, presiding officer. The Tories privatise an asset, not currently. The Tories privatise an asset. Serco bids to manage that asset. Serco cuts the services to the bone and posts a handsome profit as a result. They operate railways, speed cameras, prison, immigration detention centres, a young offenders institution, and air traffic control. One investigation into Serco's past reports the tragic death of 19-year-old Ben Woollacott, employed by Serco as a deckhand on the Woolwich Ferry in south-east London. Mr Woollacott died as a result of injuries sustained at work, having been dragged overboard by a mooring rope on the 3rd of August 2011. The Maritime Accident Investigation Branch reported in August 2012, having found that Serco Woolwich Ferries had no safety management system for the standard practice of unmooring the vessel, and a number of other safety shortcomings were evident. On the 22nd of October this year, the Inner London Crown Court ruled that Serco must pay fines and legal fees of £200,000 for the safety failings that contributed to Mr Woollacott's death. Serco also bid for NHS contracts in England with unacceptable practices resulting. For example, in September 2012, presiding officer, Serco were found to have reported inaccurate data 252 times to the Cornwall Primary Care Trust over its performance in providing out-of-hours GP services. The contract for this out-of-hours work has now been awarded to a local GP collective. But more importantly, in 2014, Serco had to repay £70 million to the UK government following a fraud investigation. The question must be asked, are they fit and proper to run our public services? Margaret Hodge, who is the former chair of Westminster's powerful Public Accounts Committee, described Serco's overbilling of the Ministry of Justice on public service contracts as, and I quote, an urgent wake-up call for the government's disastrous contract management. Let us today, presiding officer, wake up before another disaster takes place and Serco wins this contract. For if Serco wins next year, they'll be paid over £1 billion by the Scottish Government, and how much of that vast sum do we think will be retained by Serco at the expense of passengers and staff? But some in the Chamber today, presiding officer, may say that if the current tender is stopped immediately, then Serco might sue the Scottish Government for their losses. But Spice have helpfully provided a link to Transport Scotland's process overview for contract bidders, which states the Scottish Government would not be liable for any costs incurred by bidders if it cancels or suspends the contract process. And section 5.4.1 of the bid says Transport Scotland may elect to discontinue or suspend the procurement process at any time without responsibility or liability to any participant. Now, the Minister continues to argue that the Government have no choice but to put these ferry services out to tender, that it's all the fault of the regulations enforced by faceless European Commission bureaucrats. But independent observers and the trade union movement do not agree with this meek surrender of our national interest as either necessary or desirable. The RMT union have repeatedly stated that under a long-standing principle called the Tickle exemption, the Scottish Government could exempt CalMac and other ferry contracts from the damaging and unpopular tendering requirement. I asked the Transport Minister if he had raised the Tickle exemption with the Commission, and he admitted he had not in a parliamentary question answered in June of this year. And I quote, the Scottish Government has not discussed the Tickle exemption with the European Commission.
Minister?
Of course, you would care to expand on the answer that I gave to you, which is that it's irrelevant in terms of the marine cabotage regulations. It still means we'd have to undertake this exercise. So stop pointing to an irrelevant matter and return to the regulations that have compelled us to conduct this exercise.
Right.
Dave Thompson.
I note what he says, but I might have some news for him later in my speech. Well, I've news for the SNP government. I have. Over the summer, I headed to Brussels. I met with Commission officials who advised me that ferry regulations do allow for the Tickle exemption to be made should conditions of public ownership be met. Presiding officer, I believe that CalMac meets the Tickle criteria. What's more, the updated 2014 EU procurement directives, which the Scottish Government have announced they must bring in by the 18th of April next year, have relaxed the TECL exemption conditions further and brought more clarity in light of the increasing case law developments over the last 10 years. The Brent London Council and the Welland Hatfield Borough Council cases of 2011 and 2013 show the TECL exemption is applicable to the UK. Furthermore, a key official within the Director General for Mobility and Maritime Transport at the Commission, who I met recently, said, and I quote, Presiding Officer, regarding the possibility of the direct award of a public service contract, that's without tendering, this is in principle accepted by the European Court of Justice case 420/04 in the case of in-house service. And with a great sense of timing, Presiding Officer, RMT have circulated to members, including the Minister, the Council's opinion on TECL. Gordon Nardell QC concluded, and I quote, neither the 1992 regulations nor the state aid rules oblige the Scottish Minister to hold a competitive tendering exercise before awarding the company, CalMac, a public service contract for the Clyde and Hebrides services. He goes on to make the valid point that member states are perfectly entitled to perform services themselves. And once an organisation, such as the Scottish Government, meets the TECL exemption, that's on control and function criteria, the funding of its operation, and I quote, does not constitute state aid. Presiding Officer, our purpose today is to stop the tender process dead in its tracks and award the contract to CalMac. Dead in its tracks and award the contract to CalMac under the TECL exemption. There may be a rare, brave and enlightened SNP backbencher who this afternoon agrees with me. I suspect not. But a decision today in favour of our motion puts the Scottish Parliament in charge, not Brussels. Now, last night, Presiding Officer, I read a speech by the late Donald Dewar, a man who I greatly respected and who supported me with constant visits to the Highlands Islands when I was a young candidate in the late 1980s and early 1990s. His speech at the opening of Parliament on the 1st of July 1999 was a spellbinding classic. I quote, today we can look forward to a time when this moment was seen as a turning point, the day when democracy was in use in Scotland. This is much more about our politics and our laws. This is about who we are and how we carry ourselves. Today could be a turning point when we put aside party interest. We think about who we are and how we carry ourselves. Support the motion at 5 p.m. Support the workers, services and customers at CalMac. All that is needed now is the will to do and the soul to dare.
I now call on Derek Mackay to speak to and move amendment number 14942.3. Minister, 10 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin on a point of consensus? That whatever our disagreement on the legal opinion or matters of interpretation, I agree with David Stewart that whatever disagreements we may have had as a government with the trade unions, and I think we had a very positive and constructive summer, we agree with defending their rights to take whatever action they believe is necessary to represent their members' interests. And on that, we certainly agree in the face of the Conservatives who wish to remove the rights of the trade unions in representing the interests of their members. In terms of ferry services, the Scottish Government recognises Scotland's ferry services provide a lifeline service for our island communities, and we are fully committed to the continued delivery of safe, reliable, publicly owned ferry services. We've invested a record £1 billion in vessels, ports and ferry services since 2007, and we have restored commercial shipbuilding to the Clyde with the construction by Ferguson Shipyard of world-leading hybrid ferries. The third vessel, MV Katrina, will be launched in Port Glasgow on the 11th of December, and we've awarded contracts worth £97 million to Ferguson's for two new major ferries for the CalMac fleet. We've delivered the new MV Lough Seaforth, invested around £30 million in harbour works for the Stornoway-Ullapool route, and we're also currently investing £18 million in the major redevelopment of the Brodick Harbour in Arran, of course.
John Lamont. We have Ms Lamont's microphone on, please.
You said that this was the Scottish Government's position that they want a publicly owned service. Do you think a private company can deliver a publicly owned service? Because by that logic, we didn't privatise the railways.
Well, it is the case, as a consequence of our designing of the tender process, that we will continue to own the vessels, set the fares, set the timetables, and in that sense, that the vessels are still publicly owned. The suggestion that we are handing it potentially a way for sale is not the case. Our investment in the road equivalent tariff has delivered significant fare reductions for passengers, cars, coaches and small commercial vehicles. We have frozen ferry fares for 2016-17 and we're in the process of finalising improvements to next year's summer timetables, delivering community aspirations and meeting the increased demand from road equivalent tariff. No previous administration has invested as much as this administration in support of our lifeline ferry services. And all this investment would indeed be at risk if we were not to tender these services in line with EU rules. The administration is 100% committed to developing and supporting Clyde and Hebrides ferry services under public ownership. Claims that these services are up for privatisation are totally untrue. As I confirmed in my statement to this chamber on the 24th of June, no matter the outcome of the tender process, all the vessels and ports currently under public ownership will remain so. We'll continue to set the routes, timetables and fares, and we will retain full control of the services provided by the operator through the public service contract as we do now. Let me also assure everyone who depends on these vital services that we're undertaking a fair, open and transparent tender process. In my statement to the Chamber on the 24th of June, I announced that we would set up an independent procurement reference panel to provide assurance that nothing has been done that could be perceived as discriminating against either bidder. The panel's first report on the initial tender was published on Transport Scotland's website on the 3rd of November. The panel concluded that the tender is fair, open and transparent. The panel further concluded that appropriate and relevant information must be made available to both participants, and that is what Transport Scotland is doing. The panel will further consider the interim and final invitation to tender, and those documents and the panel's comments will also be published, emphasising our commitment to a fair, open and transparent tendering process. The people who rely on these lifeline services can and therefore have the highest levels of confidence that this is a fair and transparent procurement process that does not favour one bidder over another. And the current tendering exercise is no different to that undertaken by the previous Labour Liberal Democrat administration when they decided it was a legal requirement to tender the current contract in 2005. Although I'll take an intervention.
At what point will the Minister acknowledge the difference that not just the existence of TECL, but case law on TECL and the decisions taken have changed the circumstances?
Minister.
You know, it's not practice to share legal advice with others, but there was a very useful exercise over the summer where that legal advice was considered, and I'm afraid that it hasn't changed from that position taken by the earlier administration. So this is indeed about compliance. I made the remark that the tender process hasn't changed, but I, as Minister, have made some changes of material significance in terms of quality. For example, the quality ratio is now much stronger than was the case under the previous tender exercise. And I wouldn't want the Labour Party to give people the impression that they handed the last contract to CalMac. It was, in fact, the SNP administration and an SNP minister that gave the award to CalMac under this administration. And it was the Labour Liberal administration that put out to tender in the first place, setting the precedent that that's the road by which we had to go down. In terms of the maritime cabotage regulations, whenever a member state concludes public service contracts or imposes public service obligations, it shall do so on a non-discriminatory basis in respect of all community ship owners. So this is a process that we are compelled to undertake. But I have done my best, and I think this is reflected by the comments of the trade unions, to safeguard the conditions and employment of staff that operate, of course.
I understand the points the Minister is making. Does he understand that it's in his power today to bring in force the 2014 procurement directives, which makes it easier to take TECL in, so you don't need to tender? It's in your hands, Minister.
Minister.
David Stewart keeps returning to the matter of legal opinion. It is our opinion that we have to undertake this process, and you cannot escape from it. So within this process, I, as Minister, have been doing everything I can to safeguard the interests of island communities and, indeed, the staff's interests as well. Now, successive Scottish administrations have attempted to achieve that exemption from tendering since 2000, and repeated attempts since to exempt ferry services have been unsuccessful. Like Labour and Liberal transport ministers before, it has been made clear that tendering this contract is a requirement under EU rules. The Scottish Parliament motion at the time indeed said that the Parliament welcomes the Scottish Executive's further detailed consideration of the EU requirements relating to the Clyde and Hebrides Lifeline ferry services, notes that the serious consequences of these services not being compatible with regulations, recognises the Executive's commitment to secure the continued employment of the Caledonian McBrain workforce and protection of their terms, conditions and pension rights, and acknowledges that the tendering of the Clyde and Hebrides Lifeline services is required to protect these vital services. And many of the Labour MSPs present know that, because they were there and that's the way they voted at the time. So why the change of position from the Labour Party when it's quite clear that we are still compelled to deliver this? The Scottish Executive subsequently published its own consideration of the requirement to tender in September 2005, and I have a copy of that document with me today. It addresses many of the issues that we're debating, and it concluded that there was a requirement to tender and bring chiefs in line with EU rail. So breaking the law is not an option. It would leave the Scottish Government open to challenge because of those European rules, and that would be a challenge to taxpayers and the services themselves. Now, claims that the award of the contract, and this has been made before, has been delayed to follow after the Scottish parliamentary elections are not true. Putting the contract issue in the invitation to tender and pause was through the summer period to have proper dialogue and engagement with the trade unions, from which the trade unions said they believed they got the best deal possible. And I think it was right at that stage to pause to ensure that we allayed the fears that were present at the time. But as a consequence, we can't reduce the timescales at both ends to carry out due diligence and a fair, open and transparent process under procurement law. We have to do it properly. If I could announce it earlier, I would, but we are sticking to that very challenging timetable in terms of submission, analysis and announcement. Negotiations, I think, with the summer helped inform that, as has the work of the Independent Procurement Reference Panel. So I believe it has been demonstrated by this and previous administrations that we do indeed need to tender these services to ensure that they meet the requirements of EU law. We're doing it in a fair, open and transparent way. We're doing so in a way that ensures the future economic, social, cultural sustainability of island communities, which of course depend on these vital lifeline ferry services. I've had an increase focused on quality and protections that I believe have given added safeguards, appreciated by many involved, and should in some way address the concerns that have been raised. But we will do our best for the staff and island communities in all of Scotland to ensure that we enhance and support these services in a way that this government has been doing since 2007. Thank you, and I move the amendment in my name.
I now call on Alex Johnson to speak to move amendment number 14942.1. Mr. Johnson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and may I begin by moving the amendment that stands in my name. Any student of politics of any duration who looked in on this debate today would be quite obviously inspired by the nature of the debate so far. Worse still, they may get the impression that they'd fallen through a time warp back to the 1970s, because the nature of this discussion so far has gone back to the good old-fashioned public good, private bad, no privatisation at any cost approach. And that's an approach I thought we'd lost a long, long time ago. But let's first look at the notion that the government, or that the Labour Party, have presented us with today. The affection for CalMac is without doubt something which exists. No, thank you, not at the moment. The affection for CalMac is genuine. And it's genuine because so many people who depend on these services know that CalMac is the provider. We on this side of the chamber hold great respect for the work of CalMac employees and the excellent safety record of the company, having operated in Scotland for over 150 years. Scotland's ferry links provide a lifeline service to residents that will be, continue to be vital in the long term, particularly in supporting industry and tourism. But the idea that this can only be done by a public sector company is something which we don't hold to be the truth. In fact, a large part of the opening speech in this debate seemed to be a direct attack on Serco itself, prejudging the outcome of the process in which we are involved. There seems to be a feeling that this should not be tendered. There seems to be a feeling on the government side that it's only tendering this process because it's a legal requirement. I think it's a failing of both the government and the main opposition party for not embracing this process, which has the potential to deliver improvements in service, greater efficiency, and something which will deliver more effective services and affordable services for both the fare payers who use these services and for the taxpayer who supports them. No, thank you. The fact is that we must get a handle on the cost of ferry services. We support in principle the notion that the government brought forward of road equivalent tariff. But in order for that to be sustained into the future, we must know what the services will cost and we must be able to control these costs. That's why the tendering process does have the potential to benefit many, including the passengers and the taxpayer, as well as those who work on the ships. It is also essential that we understand that this government has not gone as far as it could or it should have. Scotland has a great many very effective small private ferry companies who have been excluded from this tendering process by the way in which the tender has been constructed. I think it's fair for me to criticise the government for having, in my opinion, assembled the process, stacked the process in such a way as to make it almost impossible for anybody to win other than the incumbent.
Minister.
Does the member not accept that's partly to do the very aim that I've suggested of safeguarding these lifeline services and not have them picked off by individual operators? The bundling was requested by the trade unions and is the right thing to do.
Mr Johnson.
The process of bundling, the complete unbundling of the services would have had that effect. But the government knows, and the minister knows, that the option to partially unbundle so as to make these contracts of a size that our other existing ferry companies could have competed in the process would have been a great benefit. It's also the case that we've got an unusual position in this debate in that after I speak, there will be an opportunity for the minister who handled the last tendering process to give his opinion on what happened during it. I look forward to hearing what Tavish Scott has to say, to bring to bear his ministerial experience of the process and to tell us what the truth is on this process that we are currently going through. It is the fact that, in my opinion, the Scottish Government have done the absolute minimum that is necessary in order to avoid crossing over European rules. They have missed the opportunity to take forward a tendering process which would have delivered much more effectively, and in so doing, they are failing service users and taxpayers alike. The guarantees that have been put in place during this process mean that the ships themselves and the handling facilities will remain in the ownership of the Scottish Government. The management of these services will be carried out by whoever wins this contract, but largely using the same staff and the same service providers that they have traditionally done. What we are arguing about today is not about a change in the way these services are delivered, more's the pity. What we are arguing about today is efficient management and effective management to provide an affordable service in the long term. I think this government has not done as much as it could, but it has done what it was required to do.
Thank you. I now call Tavish Scott to speak to and move amendment number 14942.2. Mr Scott.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The truth, Mr. Johnson, is we lost a vote, and one or two colleagues on the far benches there will remember it well. Back in 2005, lots of Labour colleagues were very exercised, and rightly so, by the requirement of the European Commission to insist on the tendering process. And in a pretty heated debate that I remember particularly well, because I reread it the other night, I see a number of people commenting following it, we lost that vote. I commend that to the Minister of the day. It's not a bad thing to lose a vote on your own backbenches now and again. I know we haven't seen much of that of late, but it's actually it's not a bad thing now and again. It certainly keeps the government very honest. And what happened as a result of that is that the Minister of the day did spend an awful lot of time in Brussels. I remember the Commissioner, who was a very amiable French gentleman by the name of Barrault, who spent, not the type you wheel, but a different kind, who spent a lot of time in very clear English saying this is what had to happen. And the truth of it is that no matter what legal advice you come up with, the European Commission do expect these services to be tendered. Exactly the same position then as it is now. On that point, I entirely agree with Derek Mackay. The point I might take slight issue with Derek Mackay, of course, is that the role reversal is, if I may say so, fairly entertaining. And that time, Fergus Ewing, not from you in fairness, Mr. Mackay, but from a number of others, who are, some of whom are still in this chamber, who sat on that. Can I finish this point? I'm trying to help you here, Mr. Stewart, because at that time, Fergus Ewing, leading for the SNP, said, "We will not tender. We shall not tender." He said that, went on to tell us that, that when the SNP took power, we will not tender. Well, let me just, I'll finish this point and then give way, Mr. Crawford, because then, and Derek Mackay rightly referred to, the decision that John Swinney took in 2007 after the election, because Mr. Swinney said in response, I think, to Mr. Gibson in the Transport Committee of the 2nd of October 2007, when we came into office, the government took the view that because of the existing approach to addressing European state aid issues was at a highly advanced state, it was best to allow these matters to run their course and come to a conclusion to ensure the continuity in the development of the Clyde and Hebrides ferry services. I rather agree with him. He was right then, he's right now.
Mr. Crawford.
I wish we're giving way. Like everyone else in this chamber, the majority in this chamber, we hope that CalMac come through this and can hold on to the tender. And there's no dispute on that. But let me just make the point to Tavish Scott. Tavish, I think you'll probably agree that in the past, when the SNP was in opposition, we were opposed to what is going on today. Well, we were at that time, we were wrong then, because we can see the circumstances now. They are wrong now in the Labour benches.
Tavish Scott.
I kind of have to agree with that. Self-evidently, that's the case. But what I do think is important is to differentiate between CERCL and the understandable concern that Mr. Stewart and others expressed about CERCL and the principle of tendering. And I just would urge colleagues on the Labour benches to bear that in mind. There'll always be more legal advice, and there'll always be a requirement on the Minister of the day, quite rightly, to spend time in Brussels and to spend time with with his lawyers seeking to improve what can be done in terms of the process of tendering. But no government, and we've been through a few different models in this place now since 1999, have found a way round or achieved an exemption. Now, Sarah Boyd was a Transport Minister, Lewis MacDonald was a Transport Minister, Sarah was, if I may say so, Transport Minister under our First Minister, Donald Dewar, that David Stewart rightly mentioned. Exactly the same thing, to my recollection, happened at that time too. We all argued for that exemption. We all sought to achieve it, but there was no way, as we found it, legally or otherwise, round it without getting into at least a court of law and probably, or more realistically, infraction proceedings by the European Commission against whoever the government of the day was. Yep.
David Stewart.
I understand the points the member is making. I wasn't criticising his time as Transport Minister. I merely make the point that before us today is QC's advice saying this is possible. The other points that the member didn't pick up was that both the ALMARC criterion and TECO were both immature at the stage of the last Labour administration. It's case law that develops this. We now see a way through. It is possible to do it. But in any dealings with the Commission, you need to know the right questions to ask. Perhaps we haven't asked them yet.
That was exactly the same position that Fergus Ewing used to take when he sat in that chair making a different legal argument but using a different criteria. The Altmark case was highlighted at that time too. I take the point about the passage of time, but I know it's not particularly helpful to Mr Stewart, but whoever the government minister is going to have to take legal advice on the basis of those cases and then has to act on that. No government of any political persuasion can knowingly seek to break the law. And I don't think Mr Stewart, if he was a transport minister, would be doing anything other than Mr Mackay is doing right now. The important point about this is if you wish to set up a tender and you wish to make it as tight as possible, that is perfectly possible to do. Mr Stewart will know well, he's a Highlands and Islands MSP. We have Serco running our services to Orkney and Shetland. It is the same skippers, it is the same crew, it is the same people working on the service who are on those boats today. And they provide a very good service, and they work very hard on behalf of local people. One of the best things, one of the most enjoyable days I spent as a transport minister was the CalMac cruise on the Sound of Slate and on the Sound of Harris. I have the utmost respect for the crews. I read the piece in the Herald today from a retiring skipper. I recognised him, and I absolutely reflect all his concern in terms of the future. But that is why the government just simply have to make sure, as Mr Mackay in fairness said, the importance and the fluidity and the transparency of that tendering procedure to protect the pensions, the terms and conditions and those other issues that Labour members have rightly highlighted in this motion.
Many thanks. And we now move to the open debate, and I call on Mike Russell to be followed by Joanne Lamont. 6 minutes are thereby, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm glad to have the opportunity to contribute to this debate. Unlike some members, I've actually been on a ferry this week. In fact, I've been already this week on 4 different ferries on 3 different routes. And one of them yesterday, a crew member stopped me and asked where I was going, and I said I was on my way to the Parliament. They said, what are you going to do there? Which is always a good question. And I said, what I'm going to do, the Labour members might learn something from this in terms of what the crew actually think. I said, I'm going to speak into a Labour debate about the privatisation of CalMac. And he said, well, the crew of this ferry know that CalMac's not being privatised. So the Labour message doesn't seem to be getting home.
Order.
Now, the reality of this situation is that CalMac is not, nor is any other organisation, going to be privatised. But the reality is also, and that's why I'm wearing this badge, the reality is also that the vast majority of people who work on the boats and who live in the communities served, and I represent more CalMac routes than any other member in this chamber, they want CalMac to win this tender. There is no doubt about that either. And I want CalMac to win this tender. But what we've got to do is to be honest about how that's going to take. David Stewart, presiding officer, quoted Donald Dewar at the start about what Donald Dewar's views were. Well, I sadly have to say to him, there's another quote from Donald Dewar that springs to mind. When you say to this chamber that they can do something, and they can do it now, and that will change everything, you're very guilty of something that Donald Dewar warned against, because Donald Dewar said that cynicism, together with unrealistic expectation, are the two great bugbears of politics. And alas, we've heard cynicism and unrealistic expectation this afternoon. Because what we should be concentrating on is not who's going to win the tender process, except to say, I want, my constituents want, for the sake of their lifeline ferries, they want CalMac to win that process. But then they want to say, what is going to be delivered? What are the real issues that affect those who rely upon those ferries every single day? And we should go through those and think about those things, because those are the things that crew members and others press me on as their representative. What are the big issues in ferries? And the minister knows them, because I am never off his back on them. I'm never stopped writing to the minister about the key issues that exist in ferries, which can be resolved. On Monday, I was on Mull. It's a busy commuting route. RET has made an enormous difference. The price has been actually more than halved in the last month, and people have noticed it. But there are difficulties. There are difficulties of timetable. They need earlier and later access to the island to allow people to work on the mainland. There are other issues too. Shortage of boats. When a problem occurs, whether it is on the Mull route or whether it's on the Isla route or anywhere else, it is a shortage of boats that is the biggest difficulty in making sure there's a continuity of service. And why is there a shortage of boats? Because the previous administration didn't build any. It is this administration that has started to build boats. And as the minister knows, we're going to have to build more and more boats, particularly to overcome problems such as those were experienced by Isla and Colonsay in the spring, where they had very severe problems caused by the breakdown of not one, not two, but 3 boats all at the same time. And there are other problems that need to be resolved. I agree with the Dunoon Ferry Action Group. I agree with them that what the major problem in restoring a vehicle service there is not just finding a body to tender for it, it is the price that CIMAL intends to charge for the pier in Dunoon. And I do think one of the big changes you could have in Scotland would be to remove CIMAL from the equation. Ferry services operated perfectly effectively without this intervening body for years. I don't think there is any necessity for CIMAL to be there. And if it's required by European law, well, here's a positive suggestion. As part of the legacy process for the Transport Committee, why doesn't the Transport Committee, on a cross-party basis, look A, at the tendering process to see if there's a way around it, and B, to look as if they could take CIMAL out of the equation? And if a cross-party committee of this Parliament could find a way forward on both, we would have the last of the tender processes, and we would also take out of the operation a body that doesn't contribute positively to it. On Friday, of course...
I hear what the member has to say, but does the member accept that the responsibility for identifying the best means of letting a tender in order to ensure the right outcome actually lies not with Parliament, but with the government?
Mike Russell.
The member has been a minister. He knows that's true. But parliamentary committees are extremely important in helping to broker agreements or discover information that can be in help to governments and to this chamber. Surely the member who's been an active committee member, I think even a convener, would see that that was a useful thing to happen. Now, we can look at some other problems that exist. We can look at the problems in Bute, and we can look at the problems in some of the smaller islands. Mike McKenzie, who is here today, is represented, he will say, lives on the island of Easdale. There are still a number of small ferry routes operated by the local authority, which the ferries plan anticipated should better be handled by a national operator. We need to get on with the process of making sure those are part of the national operator, and we need to join up infrastructure. Because when that happens on an island such as Kerrera, the fact there is no road north to south in Kerrera means that that investment is largely wasted. And that's also true on Mull, where in actual fact a new ferry, a bigger ferry, would create problems with the amount of traffic that's coming. But by and large, the Scottish Government should be happy with its achievements. It published a ferry plan in 2012. There was a vision of what could be done. That might need to be revisited every few years. That would be a good thing to happen. But it's the SNP Scottish Government that took forward RET, discussed in the Western Isles since the 1970s, now in place and completed the task in time. It's an SNP government that started building ferries again. I want the government to build more ferries, but it started building them again. And it's an SNP government that's taken forward a fully transparent process of tendering, not like the last process and subject to community review. So after the 2016 election, there'll be a lot to be done, but I do think it's only the SNP that's capable of doing it.
Thanks so much. Now call on Joanne Lamont to be followed by Mike McKenzie.
Thanks very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I have to say, if that was an appeal for cross-party working, he could have been a little bit more positive and a little less partial in the comments that he had to make. And I have to confess, Deputy Presiding Officer, that I have an emotional, if not sentimental, connection to the issue of CalMac and the services they provide to communities across Scotland. My own father worked for Caledon McBrains, and we knew from very early on the risks he and his fellow workers took to deliver services to remote communities. My own life has been peppered with journeys to the islands, both to work and to meet family. And I understand, as many in this chamber do, the significance of these services and the importance of this debate, which has to go far beyond simply making partial comments about which one of us got things wrong most often. But be clear, the case for defending CalMac and a publicly owned lifeline service goes far beyond sentiment. It is rational and makes economic and social sense. It is central to supporting our island and remote communities. It is about sustaining these communities as thriving modern places, stemming the depopulation that my generation understood and creating real economic opportunity. Not just economic opportunity to get skilled jobs working for Caledonian McBrain, but for businesses to run businesses, develop enterprises that take advantage of modern communication and which can rely and thrive if there is a public transport service to serve them. These lifeline services not only provide transport, but because individual ferry services exist, which no private enterprise would ever have taken on, because they exist, there are then opportunities to create business. For example, on the island of Tyree, they were able to develop surfing tourism precisely because there was already a lifeline ferry service there.
Minister Derek Mackay.
I actually don't doubt for a minute Joanne Lamont's care for the lifeline services that are delivered. But does Joanne Lamont not also appreciate that I've made the point that the vessels and the timetables continue to be set by ministers and there is no threat to the ferry services, the routes or the timetables? Those matters will continue to rest with responsible Scottish Government ministers, whoever they may be.
Lamont.
The workforce might have something to say about what their terms and conditions might be under a different employer. And we do know that there has to be money taken from somewhere to provide private profit. For, of course, this has always been, as already said by Tavish Scott, a controversial issue, and indeed resulted, as I recall, in a number of rebellions, which did shift the position of the then Scottish Executive, particularly around the question of unbundling the routes. And that has been, I think, a very important step. And in 2005, there was a reluctant acceptance, certainly on behalf of some, of the need to detender. But then very significant work was done to ensure that any privateers looking to make a fast buck at the expense of workers' terms and conditions would be deterred. And as a consequence, only CalMac did bid and CalMac secured that contract. And as a consequence, CalMac has returned surpluses to the Scottish Government every year since the contract was let to them. So we are actually in a positive place, providing a good service and returning money to government. That approach, I have to say, is in sharp contrast to Scottish Government's Ferries Review in 2012, which does comment on the benefits of competition in offering the potential for reduced subsidies. And I think this is at the heart of some of this debate. The Government is trying to speak with two separate voices, recognising the benefits of competition, and others trying to say we have to do this in order to protect CalMac. We need to be clearer about what that position is, because we are now in a position where there are two bidders, one of which is CalMac, which has delivered successful services, and the other is Serco, which even in the private world of Alec Johnson, surely there is a contrast there in the quality of that service. A Serco which cannot now bid for UK government contracts on the basis of its history and its financial roadworthiness. Can I ask the Scottish Government, have they tested the viability of Serco to take on this contract? Do they have that option to decide that they're not suitable bidders? I believe that they do have that. Critically, we also have legal advice via RMT and from what my colleague David Stewart has said, that would be possible for the Scottish Government to seek an exception. What has been done to test this? Why not go to Europe? This is not a government who has lived its life defending what the last government has done. This is not a government who has been afraid to take on Europe. Why, in this case, have they not satisfied us by showing that they are willing to ask that question? So, this is a serious time, a serious matter, and I urge again the Minister not to shoot the messenger, but listen to the message sent by the unions and local communities. And Mike Russell may want to ask why those very crews organised in their unions are raising these concerns. Perhaps it's because they understand and fear what may be ahead of them. So despite all the mythologising about who said what when, there is really only one question. Which side is the Scottish Government on? Does it want CalMac to survive to deliver this critical public service and returning money to the public purse? And if the answer is yes, then can we get the Government to test the argument to destruction? My suspicion, you see, is that there are genuinely people in this chamber on the government side who want CalMac to survive, but there are others who are quite content if they get for a cheaper buck Serco to do the job instead. I urge SNP backbenchers to recognise the case that is being made and defend your communities, not simply defend your government. Listen not to me, but to those who work in and benefit from these ferry services. Listen to the member of RMT who came to the rally and put it simply to me this afternoon. This has been hanging over us for 20 years. It needs to be sorted. So please, Minister, if you're serious in your protestations that you want to protect high-quality public ferry services in the Clyde and the islands, test the argument. Use the power that you have got. Take on the legal argument. Go to Europe, ask for an exemption, and if you do that, I can assure you, people on this side and across communities across Scotland will applaud you.
Many thanks. A little more time available than I had thought. I can now give you up to 7 minutes. Call on Mike McKenzie to be followed by Duncan McNeill. Up to 7 minutes, Mr. McKenzie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I find myself in a curious position of disagreeing with Mr. Russell,
and agreeing with Mr Scott, because Mr Russell doesn't represent the greatest number of ferries in Scotland. I do. And I agree with Mr Scott, not that I didn't share the concerns about Serco taking over the North Link ferries. Certainly.
Mike Russell.
Just for the sake of accuracy, I think I said I was the constituency MSP who represented the most CalMac ferry routes, but I do defer to you as ever.
Thank you very much, Mr Russell. I shared the concerns when Serco took over the North Link ferries, but I am forced to concede and to admit, as Mr Scott has outlined, that the service that they've been providing is excellent. And that's not my view, because my view in these matters is not as important, perhaps, as the view of my constituents on Orkney and Shetland. And having been on Orkney just last weekend and on Shetland a couple of weeks beforehand, I discovered that my constituents on these islands, on these groups of islands, are actually pleasantly surprised to find that the service has got better, not worse.
Would the member take an intervention on that point?
Very briefly.
John Finlay.
Would he agree that for the staff who have been placed in short-term contracts, that's not an improvement?
I can say to Mr Finney that I also recently took the time, whilst aboard one of the boats, the Hamnavo, I think it was, to speak to the staff, to speak to a number of the staff, and most of them seemed to feel that their worst fears had not materialised. No, I'm sorry, I'm now pressed for time. But there is no doubt, Presiding Officer, that CalMac, as the company is now known, has an affectionate place in the heart of all Islanders, myself included. My grandfather worked for CalMac. My father worked for CalMac as a young man, although in their days the company was known as Caledonian McBrain. And even Parahandy himself worked for a time for CalMac, although in his time with the company it was called David McBrain. And it largely came into public ownership in 1948. And in 2006, as we've heard, the assets and the operating company were separated in response to EU state aid rules, and CMAL was set up. But the point I'm making, Presiding Officer, is that the name has changed over the years, and the structure of CalMac has undergone several changes over the years. But the public essentially regard it as the same company and regard it with continuing affection. And it's worth reflecting that the connectivity to and from our islands, first made available by McBrain's predecessor, David Hutchison and Company, in 1851, has improved enormously over the years, with the only exceptions perhaps being during the war years. And when I tap into the collective memory of my friends and my family and neighbours, many of them working for or with friends and family working for CalMac, many of them retired mariners with stories as varied and humorous as those of Parahandy himself. No, thank you. I hear recollections that each of these changes in name and in structure have been preceded by a sense of foreboding and communal angst. And in each of case, all of these fears have failed to materialise. I'm reminded, Presiding Officer, of Mark Twain's wisdom when he said near the end of his life, "I'm an old man and my life has been full of troubles, most of which never happened." The fact is, Presiding Officer, that the service has continued to improve over the years, beyond the wildest dreams and expectations of previous generations. The fact is that in real terms, it's never been easier or cheaper to travel to our islands. And the fact is that no Scottish Government has done more to improve ferry transport than this Scottish Government, with over £1 billion spent in ferries and infrastructure since 2007, with the completion of the rollout of RET by the end of this Parliament, exactly as promised in their manifesto, with the added capacity now planned on almost all of the Clyde and Hebridean routes to cope with the anticipated increase in demand. And all in all, and during a time when the Scottish Government budget has been falling, this is no mean achievement. Presiding Officer, this is the face
of good government. This is what good government looks like. This is the good government that was most noticeably absent in the years prior to 2007. And the shame is, and shame on you, is that despite this, the Labour Party seeks to be an agent provocateur. They seek to stir up discontent. They blow in the small embers of discontent in the hopes that they'll fan the flames into a bonfire. The hope that somehow, somehow, this will bring them some political advantage. The EU state aid rules are clear. The roots must be timbered. The Labour Liberal Democrat coalition, as Tavish Scott has outlined, faced exactly the same problem in 2005. Presiding officer, having spent some time at sea myself, I can confirm that our ships and our boats are full of forecastle lawyers. The pubs and the bars ashore are even worse. They're sometimes crowded with these sea lawyers, all of whom can make legal judgments with astounding and immediate certainty. I suspect that Mr Stewart has perhaps spent too much time in the company of some of these sage
members
advisors.
In his last minute.
No,
members
thank you, I'm in my last minute. But as an islander myself, coming from a long line of islanders, no thank you, I can certify that islanders will always complain about their ferry services, sometimes with merit, often with merit, but sometimes not. Their lifeline services, and it's only when you've been dependent on them for years that you realise how vitally important they are and how islanders can easily feel insecure about changes.
You must close. Thanks very much.
It matters not who sits in the boardroom.
Thank you very much. I'm now calling on Duncan McNeill to be followed by Kenneth Gibbs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I hope that my motives will not be misconstrued today. I have a responsibility to highlight many of the concerns that my community have. We have lots of interest in the future of this tender process. But it has been an enjoyable meander through the years, a canter through the years, because I think it is important to recognise that this has been long debated in this chamber. And I don't think there's anything bad about that. I think that's honest, because we're dealing with a very difficult situation. The public record will show, I hope, that I've been consistent in expressing the concerns, including voting against my own government at that time, and the government lost their motion that evening. I remember being taken in front of the works as a consequence. Not something that would happen nowadays, but it did in those days. We have in the amendments today, predictable, you know, given that we go back far enough to Michael Forsyth in 1993 or whatever it was, you know, we had this spectre raised, and it's been consistently coming back prior to when we even had a parliament. So having an honest debate about that. But one thing that strikes me is that we have been consistent, as well as myself being consistent, I think governments and politicians have been consistent, and that is to insist that no stone should be left unturned in this tendering process. No stone should be left unturned. If there are opportunities to cease this tender, we should be taking them. We shouldn't, as a government and a parliament supporting the trade union's right to take them, we should be side by side with those trade unions to test this process. My interest, of course, it's got to be declared, is not so much on the passenger side. It is, if you like, on the producer side of this debate. We have CalMac headquarters at Gourock, which provide us with many hundreds of jobs, significant investment in our community, highly paid jobs, which there are no certainties at all that headquarters would. I see the Minister, and I'll give way to the Minister. Yep.
I would just want to, I suppose, preempt the point for Duncan McNeill in a very helpful way. A lot of members don't seem to be aware that I've built into the procurement exercise a mechanism that disincentivises any bidder from stripping out headcount numbers, and that mechanism is new and designed to try and protect the staffing numbers within organisations to remove any incentive to just strip out staff that I know people were concerned about. Does that go some way to allay the fears of members?
You know, we have one of the other different things that we have from the historical discussions about this is that we've got Serco on the scene. They gave quite clear, you know, in the Northlink contract, they gave quite clear assurances that there wasn't there a track record to reduce staffing. But however, the chief executive of Serco Northlink was boasting at a transport event quite recently. It may be the same captain on the ship, it may be the same people on the ship, but there's, after their actions, there has been 85 less of them, and those who are employed are not necessarily employed in the previous contract. So please, please give some respect for the concern for the people who are here today. Their concerns are serious and worrying. In addition to the CalMac headquarters, I don't believe that there's sufficient assurances in there for the headquarters themselves. I understand that CMAL own the headquarters, so I don't know where that transfers at all to the winning bidder, if that be Serco. It's just another complication. But I think we should at least try very, very hard to get those assurances. I've been asking for 2 years to get those assurances. I don't know where they're in place yet. I'm sort of limited for time. Okay.
Mike Russell.
Because I think there is genuine dubiety about headquarters, and as the member knows, Serco is not being clear about where its headquarters will be, but it appears to be say to anybody who asks it that the headquarters might be on their island, which is a bit confusing.
Duncan McNeill.
I'm pleased that I took the intervention now because it allows me to say that the team that have been engaging with those island communities have told the good people of Jura. Indeed, and it was reported in the local newspaper, that there will be no headquarters. You know, so how do we create a situation that could cost my community 200-odd jobs? I should go on to say, because as has been mentioned earlier, we have got a cluster of marine businesses and experience in the Inverclyde area. We've got CMAL in Port Glasgow. We've got Ferguson Shipbuilders, so recently built up in Good News. And we have also got Garville Dye Dock, Forth Marine, who carry out maintenance and repair to CalMac vessels. So we build the vessels, we help procure and develop new models of vessels in the area, and we've got a headquarters function that supports jobs. There is absolutely, unfortunately, not enough assurances about the headquarters, the people who are employed there, the impact that that will have on my community, and indeed the impact the knock-on impact that could have on the other businesses in the Inverclyde area. Until that happens, I will not be supporting it, and I do not believe, with all of those consequences in play, that we should leave any stone unturned to ensure that we get fairness in this process.
Many thanks. Now, Colin Kenny-Gibson, to be followed by John Finney.
I thank you, Presiding Officer. As MSP for Cullium North, I am lucky enough to represent the island communities of both Arran and Cumbrae, and with a total of 3 CalMac ferry routes in these islands, I'm more than aware of the vital role our ferry services play in ensuring the island communities I represent remain resilient. CalMac and its workforce play a key part in this, and of course the hard work of CalMac employees is extremely well regarded and well respected, not just by islanders but also by visitors themselves. One of the reasons being that CalMac employees, particularly in bad weather and other adverse conditions, often go that extra mile to ensure not only that visitors are safe but also comfortable as far as conditions allow. Now, as we've heard, since taking office in 2007, this SNP government has recognised the unique needs of our island communities. I mean, the Transport Minister is also Minister for the Islands, and we've invested heavily to ensure they're well connected to boost tourism and their economies and enhance export opportunities. A record £1 billion has now been invested over the last 8 years or so in port infrastructure, new vessels and ferry services. and Brodick Harbour on the Isle of Arran is soon to benefit from SNP government investment with a contract to transform that ferry terminal. Worth over £22.2 million, this contract is only part of a major investment of around £30 million, which will secure a safe, efficient and reliable ferry terminal in service, with work due to start this winter and finish early in 2017. And the harbour development includes a link span, which the previous Labour Liberal Democrat administration should have renewed in 2002, but never did, despite having greater resources and huge cash underspends. And it has to be said that many people on Arran take the view that that island was just not important enough to those parties when they were in office. Working to ensure that services are improved further, the SNP government has awarded a £97 million contract to the once ill-fated Ferguson's shipyard on the Clyde to build two large dual-fuel ferries, which will serve the Clyde Islands as well as other islands in Scotland. And each vessel will have increased passenger vehicle capacity with 1,000 passengers and 127 vehicles, creating and sustaining hundreds of jobs in the west of Scotland in the process. On top of this, the Arran Summer Ferry service with the MV Isle of Arran working with the Caledonian Isles has been extended to 5 months and in 2008 should be extended with a new vessel replacing the MV Isle of Arran to an all-year-round service. And of course, each year the SNP government is supporting a road equivalent policy to tariff policy to Arran and Cumbria to the tune of over £2.8 million just for those two islands each year. I can say from first-hand experience the introduction of this policy has made huge differences to island constituents, with the cost of taking the car to the ferry reduced by some 57%. And not only is this of great financial benefit to islanders, but the boost to the tourism sector on our islands has been marked, and I'm confident with new ferries in place, increased capacity and a targeted marketing strategy, visitor numbers will only grow, helping to support dozens of businesses on the islands of Arran and Cumbria. Now, based on this unprecedented programme investment, there can be no doubt the SNP government is intent on delivering the best ferry service possible for islanders and visitors right across Scotland. And while I understand some of the concerns of members opposite, I think that at least should be accepted. Now, keeping our ferry service in public hands is critical to achieving this aim and allows the government maximum flexibility in ensuring needs and demand is met. And of course, the fact that the Scottish Government has not unbundled the services has shown great intent in that regard. And for that reason, the SNP government, as the Minister has made clear, has absolutely no plans to privatise this vital transport network and will continue to keep our ferry services in public hands, despite financial challenge. And whilst we've heard claims that legal loopholes could be used to avoid the tendering process entirely, since the last tender process, an exhaustive European Commission state aid investigation has strengthened the legal requirement. With regards to TECL exemption, which has been raised by the RMT and some members opposite today, it remains the case that the European Commission's maritime cabotage regulation still requires Scottish ministers to put those services out to tender, given the provision of state aid. Yes, I'll be happy to take an intervention.
Dave Stewart. I mentioned the RMT's QC's advice on this, which says the opposite of what the member's just said. Has the member had the opportunity to look at the advice? I appreciate it was fairly near before the debate, but the advice is very clear that the government can use the TECL exemption to avoid tendering for the service.
Mr Gibson. Standing as the Cabinet Secretary for Infrastructure, Investment and Cities met with senior officials to explore further potential to avoid tendering of the contract, and the Commission reiterated its position, I would re-emphasise, that the maritime cabotage regulation, in line with the principles of the EU treaty, requires non-discrimination between operators, and therefore the open and transparent competitive tendering exercise, which is now being undertaken, has to proceed. Now, of course, the SNP government is committed to maintaining standards of service, and we wish to see workers' rights protected. I'm therefore pleased that, along with the First Minister, the Transport Minister and the trade unions, an independent procurement reference panel was announced on the 24th of June to ensure fairness, openness and transparency and provide assurance of no discrimination against either bidder. Scottish ministers have further made it clear that they will protect employees' terms and conditions, including a fair, affordable and sustainable pension scheme and the inclusion of fair work principles in the next contract. Ministers are also seeking a no-compulsory redundancy agreement from the bidders during the tendering process. And I believe that within the confines of procurement law, the Scottish Government is doing an excellent job to ensure the successful bidder provides not mere value for money, but a high-quality service for the people who use these services, which is fair to employees and delivers for our customers. Of course, talk of privatisation is far from the truth, and any service whereby the government retains ownership of vessels, ports and harbours, whilst also setting routes, timetables and fares, cannot be considered privatisation. Coupled with the huge levels of investment in port infrastructure, RET, new vessels and the Scottish Government's ambitious ferries plan, it's clear, Presiding Officer, that under the SNP Government, Scotland will continue to benefit from a world-class ferry service which will improve standards of living on our island communities and provide a boost to tourism, employment and island exports. And indeed, certainly in my constituency, we have already seen such progress.
Many thanks. Now call on John Finney to be followed by Rob Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I apologise to you in the Chamber for missing Mr Stewart's opening remarks? Like many, Presiding Officer, I attended school on a McBrains bus for many years, and there was Hollage, McBrains Hollage. And CalMac has its origins in that Highland history, as has been said, deep part of the Highland history, I think in the DNA, someone said. And that used to be the case with another public body. That used to be the case with the Hydro Board. There was great affection for the Hydro Board from the period of construction, Tom Johnson at the end of the Second World War, to the operation, to the large workforce it created. They all had, there was a lot of housing connected with the work there, and it had a special place in the communities. And that's no longer the case. And that's no longer the case because of the privatisation of the utilities. It ended all that. The profit motive ended all that. And that's not a model I would like to see repeated in respect of these important services. I'm grateful to the many people who have provided briefings for today's events and I'm sure that we can all do some selective quoting from it. I certainly intend to. We hear that under the procurement directives, and I quote, under the previous regime, waterborne transport services were non-priority services. Well, I don't think the importance of the ferry service to our communities can be underestimated. Now, the term public sector obligations can mean different things to different people, and on a political level, it does mean, do you see a role for the state in people's lives? Well, I have to tell you, I view transport service as much as I view education, much as I view health and social care. And people have talked about the tackle, and again, would maybe choose to use selective phrases. I share David Stewart's view, and I have to admit that I didn't get through the 26 pages or whatever. I got through 14 of them, but of course, the meat's in the initial opinion, and that advice is unequivocal. And if, as expressions appear to come from the government backbenches, people are genuinely interested in CalMac securing, then can I commend that to them? And I'll maybe return to that later. We know there's support for rail services to be in the public sector. That's, again, plenty of evidence about that. And touching on Mr Johnson, when he declined taking earlier intervention, of course, we do know that East Coast failed twice in private franchise. It ran very successfully as a state enterprise. Now, you and I might see that the opportunity to run that model out to other rail franchises, not the UK government. They now intend to hand over these profits to their friends in the city. People are looking for consistency about this, and people have talked about the various positions that the parties have adopted. I have to say my Green colleagues have been consistent throughout in this, but it's right to say that events change and are shaped by case law, and I think it's important that we pay attention to that. But of course, case law counts for nothing if there isn't political will, and I think that's the most important thing that will shape that. Now, there are many obligations that are placed in a government. There's also an obligation placed in a company, a limited company, and that obligation is to maximise profits for its shareholders. Now, there's no doubt that commercial concerns can run public services, and unfortunately many do, but at what price? The first occasion I spoke in here was about care of older people, and my concern that there was a profit motive attached to the care of older people, likewise with prisons. Now, declare my membership of the RMT Parliamentary Group, and the RMT campaign states, Serco are the specialists in failure. And they tell us that's based on an appalling track record in public services. Of course, we don't just need to take RMT's word for that. Mr Johnson's colleagues in the UK government, as we've heard, form that view too. Now, bad state of affairs. If Tories in London are saying one thing, are recognising the frailties of that organisation, we are setting that aside here. And of course, the union briefings also tell us something that we'd know already, and that is, and I quote, profits among companies in the UK and international industry are reliant on keeping labour costs down at the expense of seafarers' employment, pension and other rights. We have TTIP on the horizon, and we have the trade union legislation, which, ironically, the government seem to express concerns about. And of course, we also know that in many instances with public services, these are driven, as one of the quotes says, by a policy of aggressive profiteering. I raised, and I was grateful to my colleague Mike McKenzie for accepting the intervention, I raised the issue of the precedent, because we can go on precedent, and I actually said short-term contracts when I should have said indeed zero-hours contracts, because despite assurances given to the RMT that they wouldn't change crewing levels before winter, Serco announced redundancies in October without prior consultation, barely 3 months into the contract. That caused the first industrial action in Scottish ferry services for 30 years. And correcting my earlier comment, the company also used zero-hours contracts for staff on vessels on these routes. Now, that's not the sort of ferry services I want to see. CalMac has its critics. These critics are very specific. I was unhappy about this performance in this particular ferry. I wish the ferry had sailed on this particular occasion. But they are highly regarded, and they are profitable. Now, I'm fascinated by this notion that this isn't privatisation, because we do know that CalMac is profitable, and that profit comes back to the government coffers. Where will any profit that any private company would make? We know where that's going. That's going to the shareholders. It's not coming here. Now, we can play with words all day long, but as far as I'm concerned, that's privatisation. I have to tell you, I'm a very old-fashioned guy. I think I like my public services run by the public, in the interest of the public. Joanne Lamont in a fine speech talked about... Yes, indeed.
Brody.
I mean, who owns and who will own the assets of the company?
John Finney.
Do you know, it's completely irrelevant to the people I represent that. They are interested in the quality of service. They are interested to know that the people who work for the ferry services are respected. We know that private companies will drive the terms and conditions, hard-fought-for terms and conditions, down. So I like my service, and I do think we need to test the destruction. And I don't think people, if they've not had the opportunity to read an opinion, I don't think they should be expressing a view and an opinion. And I hope that the Minister will be open-minded in that. There's a phrase, knowing the cost of everything and the value of nothing, and that very much applies in this instance. I would hope... I'm very happy to take an intervention from the Minister.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I just wasn't sure if the member had time. Repeatedly asking, as Labour members, have we tested the legal opinion to destruction? Can I say, is the member aware that both trade union solicitors and government solicitors did spend some of the summer discussing matters, raising awareness, without sharing legal opinion, to understand each other's position? And therefore, I am convinced that we have tested to destruction the legal opinion that's led us to the conclusion that we've reached.
Mr. Finney, begin to draw to a conclusion.
Yes, indeed. Well, as someone who in a previous job used to seek legal opinions, I can say that in some instances legal opinion can you give me everything that would support my assertion that A is B? What I'm saying to you, Minister, is that this is a recently, it literally has come in within the last while, and I hope that you would take the opportunity to look at that, even at this 11th hour, because if there is a genuine commitment, and everyone seems to be saying they want CalMac to win it, if there's a genuine commitment to that, then I'm sure if you take that on board, everyone would be appreciative of that. And I certainly want to see CalMac retain these services. And I thank David Stewart for bringing this motion to us.
Thank you. I call Rob Gibson to be followed by Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Deja vu all over again, as they say. This kind of debate took place in 2005. We've had references to that, and I think it's important, you know, to state for a fact that I also am now the constituency member for Caithness, Sutherland and Ross, so therefore I have both the CalMac service from Ullapool to Stornoway and the Serco services across the Pentland Firth from Scrabster. I can compare and contrast, but I also have a wider experience. Indeed, the land reform work of our committee took us to Isla and Jura recently, so we've been using a number of ferries. Indeed, I went via Arran and Kintyre. So I've witnessed what's going on in the ferries in that respect, and that doesn't give me an overall view of what the state of the ferries are. But this debate is about a whole issue that the crews and the unions and others want settled for good. whether it's possible, presiding officer, to get to a stage where TECL is a solution to that is quite complicated. Now, the EU states that tendering is needed by law, as established in the executive's time, and which we have followed in the SNP governments. But if TECL is not a silver bullet and is very complicated, and as the Minister says, isn't a fait accompli, how could we spend a lot of time at this stage putting back a tendering process which we might be found to be an infraction over? And as Maureen McMillan said, you know, we've got to face facts, and this is in 2005. If we fail to comply swiftly with the European directive, the tendering of the ferry services could be taken out of the executive's hands. Now, I don't think that we should take that threat lightly. From a Labour member, that was quite an important matter to say. Not at the moment, thank you. The risk that is being run in order to be able to suggest that this is new information and opinion, one idea about how TECL would work, is all very well. So as my colleague Mike Russell said, if that's something which really matters, then it's possible for that to be explored at length, not in the middle of a tendering process, because Maureen McMillan's stricture is there. And it's also the fact that, as Tavish Scott said, we're not dealing with the other aspect of Labour's motion about privatisation. The hardware stays in public hands. The ferries, the services, the timetables, the fares, and most importantly, because of the tender conditions, the pensions of the workforce, which have been safeguarded in this tendering process, which were not safeguarded in the tendering process in 2005. I mentioned it at that time myself. Now, as far as I'm concerned, I'm sorry, I'm not taking one at the moment, but I may in a minute. The employees are being safeguarded. There isn't a question of non-compulsory redundancies being able to be carried out without consultation with the minister. The kinds of conditions that are being put now into this contract are very different to the ones which pertained in the past. Now, as I said, we've got CalMac as it is at the present time, and there's been some discussion about just exactly what kind of job it does and whether it could do a better job. And there has been a lot of discussion about the way in which the parts of the CalMac organisation suggest particular types of vessel that should be investigated at greater length. It's been suggested, for example, that the recently built Loch Seaforth, which runs on the Ullapool Run, which cost over £43 million, could instead have been used to create three 140-car rough-water catamaran ferries, which might have been more flexible to use on many routes in CalMac. We've got to use worldwide experience when we're thinking about the best way to use the public services that CalMac provide, and that's a part of the debate that we've got to get onto. But I would suggest to you that if Labour is going to continue to advocate an approach which doesn't work, such as TECL, is it then suggesting that we should flout EU law? As I said at the beginning, in the middle of a tender process, if you stop it at that point, are you then saying that you're prepared to flout EU law? Because if that's what the motion is saying today, then I'm sorry, as far as I'm concerned, I cannot accept that approach. What I understand is it is a faux argument, because this is not about privatisation. This is not about anything other than grandstanding. And the interests of the workforce in CalMac and the communities they serve are best looked after by the SNP government under this minister.
Sorry, Mr. Are you finished, Mr. Gibson?
Thank you, President.
I thought you were taking an intervention. Thank you. I now call Neil Bibby, to be followed by Chick Brodie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. CalMac ferries not only provide vital lifeline services to Clyde and Hebridean Islands, they are also a much-loved national institution. I know what a vital service CalMac provides. My brother used to work on the ferries. My wife's family live in the Hebrides. And like many, I also regularly visit places like Arran, Millport and Rothesay using the ferry. I therefore strongly believe that everything should be done to protect CalMac services from privatisation, and we should listen to those passengers who use the service and the workers who run it. That's why I welcome the debate today in Scottish Labour's motion in the name of David Stewart. CalMac is today in 2015, thankfully, in public hands. But unlike in 2005, we have a very serious and very real threat of privatisation. It is very real and very serious threat because the Minister, Dermot Mackay, simply cannot give a guarantee that Serco will not be successful and cannot promise us that this private company will not be running those services next year. And what makes the threat of privatisation all the more real and worrying is that the Government have said that the tendering process will not be completed until after the next Scottish Parliament elections in May. The motion today rightly recognises the sterling work of all the workers and members of the RMT, Unite, TSSA and Nautilus. But we shouldn't just recognise the workers, we should listen to them and the unions on this issue, many of whom I met outside at the lobby today and are in the chamber this afternoon. And I've got to say, Presiding Officer, I didn't see many SNP MSPs outside meeting the workers this afternoon for all the talk of listening to the workers. We should listen to what they have to say, and we should listen to what they have to say about some of the bizarre claims from the Minister, particularly that this tendering process does not represent privatisation. I'll tell the Minister what Mick Cash, the RMT General Secretary, has said about that claim. He said it's extraordinary that rather than standing up for Scotland's lifeline ferry services, those who hold political power have resorted to ludicrous arguments about what does and doesn't represent privatisation. That is a kick in the teeth for loyal and hard-working staff. He also rightly said, if a private company is allowed to take over a public service for profit, that is privatisation, whether it's on our railways, hospitals or ferry services. Like Brian Wilson and others have said, by the Minister's definition, nothing has been privatised. We should also listen to the concerns of workers over the reported plans by Serco to degrade the headquarters. As my colleague Duncan McNeill said, around 200 people are employed at the Gourock office in Inverclyde, and the insufficient assurances have been given on that matter. And this is yet another reason why we shouldn't be proceeding with the tender. But crucially, the SNP government must also now act upon the new legal advice published today by EU procurement law expert Gordon Nardell QC. As my colleague David Stewart said earlier, this advice has shown that by applying a provision known as the TECO exemption, the Scottish Government does not need to put the service out to tender. In Gordon Nardell QC's opinion, this case satisfies both the control test and the functional test required by the TECO exemption. Yeah, I'll take Mike McKenzie.
Mike McKenzie.
Would you not agree with me that it's a very, very common thing for one lawyer to say one thing and another lawyer to say another? That's why we have court cases.
Neil Bibby.
Well, I think your speech said nothing at all, and I would rather take Gordon Nardell QC advice on EU procurement matters rather than Mike McKenzie's, but thanks for your intervention anyway. Gordon Nardell QC's legal advice is clear. Scottish ministers are not obliged to hold a competitive tendering exercise before awarding that company a public service contract for the Clyde Hebrides services. Nardell is clear that once the TECO exemption is satisfied, this is a highly significant intervention. It begs the question why the Minister and the Scottish Government have not asked the European Commission for a TECO exemption. I have to point out to the Minister and other members that on page 23 of Nardell's advice, he states that once the TECO exemption is satisfied, the funding for that operation does not constitute state aid, which has been the previous reason why the Minister has been reluctant to take that. Yes, certainly will.
Minister.
The member has, as many members have, returned to legal opinion. Let's turn to the opinion of European commissioners, who have said, consequently, the Commission strongly advocates the widest possible use of open and transparent tendering procedures when public authorities entrust companies with a public service obligation. That's the view of the Commissioner. That's the view of the Commission. Doesn't he understand that that is a significant statement that suggests that we are right to have to undertake this procurement exercise?
I'm not even sure if the Minister has read Gordon Nardell QC's legal advice, but I would encourage him to do so because of what he has said. Surely it is only reasonable that if there is agreement we don't want to tender and legal advice backs us up, that we stop the tendering process and go back to the European Commission for that exemption. It would be indefensible now not to, given the publication of that advice today. I have a number of other questions for the Minister. The tender process is time-consuming, but we also know it will be costly. Can the Minister give us an updated estimate on the total costs of the tendering process? Can he also confirm, as Spice and Gordon Ardell QC have done, that the Scottish Government have the unequivocal right to cancel a tendering process at any time without any liability? And lastly, if he's so confident these services won't be privatised, can he give a guarantee that Serco won't be running these ferry services next year? Well, of course he can, and he knows he can, unless he wants to tell me Serco won't be running the ferry services next year.
As the member knows very well, or certainly should know if he's an expert on legal opinion, if I was to prejudice this exercise, yes, the government would be in difficulty, as would I, and as would our ferry services. So, of course, I can't prejudice the outcome of a tendering exercise. We will continue to monitor the costs of it, and we cannot absolutely prejudice the outcome of it. We'll run it fairly, openly and transparently to ensure that it complies with European law.
Neil Bibby, I'll give you your time back.
Well, that's all very well, Minister. You're saying it could be privatised, and that's exactly why we're saying to stop the process. I have to say, Presiding Officer, I would have thought the SNP would have been working with us today to ensure that we keep CalMac in public hands. I thought this because it's been mentioned. As been mentioned, SNP MSP Fergus Ewan said in 2005 that an SNP government would not tender. Instead, it would protect CalMac and its workforce and improve the ferry services to our island communities in Scotland. I have to say, it's all very well for SNP MSPs to come to this chamber and say they stand up for Scotland, but the reality is, Presiding Officer, SNP MSPs like Kenny Gibson aren't even standing up for Millport on this issue. I was in Arran just 2 weeks ago and I spoke to people there who were in no doubt that CalMac should be kept in public hands and the tender should be stopped. Other SNP MSPs here like Alistair Allen and Mike Russell need to realise that they're only here because people in island communities voted for them, and to be complicit with a privatisation process would be a betrayal to those island communities. Presiding Officer,
I
think the word complicit needs to be considered carefully by the member. I've already explained to him what the position is in terms of the crew I know and speak to and my constituents. Perhaps he'd like to come and speak to them. He won't hear much about ferries in Paisley.
Neil Bibby, if
you want to stand up for your constituents and you want to stop this privatisation process, you'll vote for the Labour motion in Dave Stewart's name tonight. Presiding Officer, in closing, CalMac ferries are lifeline services. CalMac is a national institution. As the RMT have said, privatise these services would be a betrayal to the Scottish people. We have the legal advice and the public on our side. Let's resolve to keep CalMac in public hands. I will stand up for my constituents and I'll support the motion in David Stewart's name.
Thank you. Chick Brody to be followed by Rhoda Grant, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think that was a rewriting, very selective rewriting of the actual situation. As a member who lives on the beautiful Firth of Clyde, and who started my work in Greenock, this is an important debate for me personally. And let me firstly make the following point. I'm not interested in the creation of division. The desire should be to meet the employees' needs, the needs of the customer, the legal needs and the productive needs of this debate. I said last week in the Trade Union Reform Bill, and I've made the point very often about employee participation in the ownership and the running of companies properly constituted, that they have a great role, a continued great role, to build the foundation of efficient, productive, good and sound labour practices, and hopefully thereby high remuneration practices across all of our critical economic sectors, including maritime transport. And while with great respect I embrace some of the intent of David Stewart and Labour's motion today, it is its content, its motivation and direction with which I have problems. So let me share some of my concerns. Firstly, and importantly, there is no mention of the customer, the taxpayer, the clients, the many islanders, those who are resident on the island, who contribute so much to Scotland's economic and cultural spectra. No mention at all. Secondly, I do pay, no, not just now. Secondly, I too pay tribute to our ferry workers, in fact, all workers involved, who help breathe a continued life into our rural and island communities. I suggest their commitment won't change. The Scottish Ministers have already indicated they will protect employees' terms and conditions with a fair pension scheme, as was just mentioned, in the next contract, as will the seeking of no compulsory redundancy agreements from the bidders. And any other suggestion that it might be otherwise, frankly, are misleading. Presiding officer, it's not for me to draw the picture of Caledonian McBrain, and it's no, not just now, let me carry on. I know I'm coming to an important point that you should listen to, and it's whole lifeline services across the 22 islands off the west coast, but rather the Clyde and Hebrides services. And I go back remembering even the streakers, the competitive Clyde ferries to Rothsay, but things have moved on, and things have moved on. And regrettably, in my interventions, which were not taken today, I wanted to ask what David Stewart and Joanne Lamont feel about the people in Hampshire who wanted to have their own local bid, or a ferry bid, accepted. But it wasn't accepted under the principle that is being applied here, under European law. The bid went to another a shipping company, and it was that of a joint bid by David McBrain, CalMac, who won the tender. So, you know, there is a recognition, at least by some in CalMac, that the progress bids in the competitive environment. It's not for me, as I say, to make any more comment on that. That outcome is quite clear. Based on competition, what I don't understand is that we now have the cri de coeur, which now shouts that there apparently should be no competition. And I've just indicated a situation where the parent company of CalMac accepts that and gets involved in the competition successfully and happily, as far as we're concerned, in winning that bid. The contract is out to tender as required by competitive European law, despite what Mr Mardell says. Council Regulation number 3577/92 applies, and since decisions and implications of the Altmark case, which has been referred to, the requirements for public tendering of public ferry services stem from the European Maritime Cabotage Regulation. And that was recognised by LibLab Transport, Mr Nicol Stephen, in 2004.
John Finney.
I'm grateful for the member.
John Finney's microphone. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm grateful for the member taking an intervention. Regardless of the issue, would the member accept that law is an evolving thing? It's not static, it can change, and this could have changed. And it's for that reason the minister should examine
And that's opinion. A very good point, technology. Because I was just coming to that, because it would come as no surprise that the volatility of some undesirable actions of some fellow members, member countries of the Union, European Union, even. You know, whatever these actions are, they shed a light in the intervening years, as you've pointed out. They shed a light on practices that, and actions that are unacceptable, and therefore there is an ongoing review, as Mr Finney's just pointed out, by EU legislators, and that's why we've had changes to the requirements in this case, procurement service contracts. If we espouse a desire to be part of Europe, and most Scots apparently wish to do so, then we must, and I quote, pursue legal arguments with the European Commission's exempt Lifeline Scottish Ferries services. We tried that, and they made the position absolutely clear. It is also a nonsense, and in fact defamatory, to suggest the process is a biased process towards private sector business. Where is the evidence that it's biased? Where is the evidence for that when any successful competitive bidder has to meet the same detailed service specification defined by our government, where our government retains control over fares, timetables, frequency of sales, where the government still controls the assets, the routes, the
Audrey,
services
please, can
and
we
the
stop
fares.
The sedentary interventions and ask Mr Brodie if you wish to intervene?
On that basis, Presiding Officer, I won't take any more interventions. On that basis, Presiding Officer, we're talking about a base for competition of operation. And what I don't understand, What I don't understand is the apparent fear in the message that we must maintain it publicly instead of getting out there and fighting to win it. Those that argue against alleged privatisation of the ferries, which, given what I've just said, is clearly not seen to defy the motion, with a strong, skilled workforce, with experience, there is the opportunity to compete. If you keep talking as if you're going to lose, guess what happens? You lose. And that's the notion. This motion defies the capability of CalMac, its workers and its representatives to go out and win it, and does no favour to its causes of fear of loss. The Labour Party should heed this.
Time is
and
up,
as with other cases, I just finished, presiding officer, the words of Charles Kettering that said, if you're still doing things the way you've always done, then you're doing it wrong. Get out there and compete.
Thank you. Can I ask our next two members to keep to their 7 minutes, please? Rhoda Grant, to be followed by Dave Thompson.
Thank you, President.
Order, please.
Thank you, presiding officer. Bruce Crawford said in his intervention that the SNP in opposition had been wrong in their response to the previous tendering process. He said they were wrong and seeks to tar us with the same brush. We were posturing then, therefore so are you now, he infers. I can say he is wrong now. This debate seeks to give the Minister the facts he needs to stop the tendering process. If he does that today, no one will applaud him louder than I will.
Minister.
That may actually help Rhoda Grant's voice, and a fair challenge that a number of Labour members have put. Whatever the outcome of the vote today or the continuation of this debate, I will meet with the opposition spokesperson and contest this legal opinion in the spirit that members have asked me to, and I make that commitment in the chamber now if that assists this debate.
Rhoda Grant.
Well, can I really welcome that intervention from the Minister, because I think that is one of the first positive things that have come from his benches today. And indeed, that's all we are asking in this debate, that he examines the truth of the matter, because we believe that it's a fact that tendering of CalMac routes is not required. And we know it to be the case. The technical exemption is there. It's been tried in case law over recent years, and directives have strengthened it. The Scottish Government know it's there, and I'm really glad they are now willing to look at this exemption. David Stewart went and spoke to the Directorate General of Maritime Affairs. Surely the Minister can do this too. Surely he can look at the QC advice obtained by the RMT that upholds the position that technical exemption can be used. That's legal advice. It's not political posturing. If it can be used, it should be used, because these are lifeline services, not for profit-making opportunities. A government-owned provider can be instructed to change the routes and the sailings at any time, and these changes can be made at cost price rather than additions to a contract, which can then be charged at the price that the contract holder demands. This is a point that was made by Captain Norman Martin. He said, the government owns CalMac. It's a private company but owned by Scottish ministers, so they have the authority to instruct you to do what they want you to do. They have the authority to appoint the directors and set the strategy. But if you go to another private operator, they are delivering a contract according to the contract that you have struck. And it's very difficult to foresee any variations you might need in advance. We can't ignore the advice of someone who served our communities for many years. Serco is the only alternative bidder, and their record at service delivery is not good. The RMT are in dispute with them about their unwillingness to respond to health and safety concerns on the railway. They run Northlink services. When the Hamnavo broke down a couple of years ago, they didn't replace it with a similar boat. It was cheaper for them to pay the fine rather than pay the cost of the replacement. This shows a total disregard for the public good, and indeed a disregard for the people they serve. It's the difference between having a privatised service and one that is run by public servants who serve their communities and react to their needs.
Alec Johnson.
Is it not the case that when the Hamnavo broke down, much of the slack was taken up by a privately run ferry, unsubsidised?
Rhoda Grant.
Yes, another, a privately run ferry service put on extra sailings, but that's a disgrace because Serco were getting the public funding to run the public service and did not do that. And if you travel on Northlink, you'll see that Serco have introduced passenger segregation. People can pay a higher price to access more stable midship seats, which are used to be available to people on a first-come, first-served basis. You can pay additional amounts to access an executive lounge and dining area. And indeed, it feels as if you're travelling steerage when you opt for a basic ticket. They use sharp practice. David Stewart talked about them claiming from the UK government monies that were not due to them for a tagging contract. They were banned from holding contracts because of this, and we're still allowing them to bid for public contracts here. If they're in the bidding process to make a profit and their record and the tagging contract shows that they're not above sharp practice, then they will maximise their profits in any way they can with these contracts. Like others, I believe that there are things that can be improved by the Scottish Government and their governance of CalMac. Scottish Government appoint the board of CalMac, and it's perplexing that they don't see fit to have someone who lives in the islands appointed to the board. There are people with huge experience and knowledge, and they would bring an island perspective to the board, and they would understand concerns, for example, of the people in Skye with regard to the Malek-Armadale route. The new arrangements won't provide an adequate service, and they see demand increasing with the introduction of RET. The crossing will now be cost-effective and provide an alternative to the round trip by road, and therefore they must have capacity to meet the demand, and they want to retain the MV Kursk. The constituents in Dunoon are also calling for the MV Kursk for the Dunoon-Gourock route to provide a safe and reliable service to their community, especially in the winter months when the journey can be terrifying because the purpose-built vessels are not fit for purpose. It is not right that the Scottish Government are allowing community to be set against community. These communities need services to meet their needs and develop their economies. Skye needs a dependable service, as does Dunoon, and they both need boats fit for purpose. The Scottish Government had 8 years to build boats. They need to do that now. Presiding Officer, this tendering process must be pulled. The Scottish Government can do this if they wish. There is no comeback under the terms of the tendering process. It's often said, where there's a will, there's a way. We know there's a way. We hope the Scottish Government have the will.
Many thanks. Dave Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a former resident of Lewis and regular ferry user up and down the Western Isles and also to the mainland, I welcome David Stewart's motion. And I do pay tribute to the ferry workers of Caledonia and McBrain, who do provide vital ferry services to much of my constituency of Skylach, Aber and Badenoch. Excuse me. And right along the west coast of Scotland. When I was in Lewis in the 70s and early 80s, there was much debate about road equivalent tariff, but successive Labour and other governments refused to implement it, and it has only been done now by our SNP Scottish Government, and they should get credit for that, because that is a huge boost to our west coast communities and to those who work for Caledonian McBrain. This debate will rightly focus on ferry service contracts and the EU legal requirement to put them out to tender. Of course, your SNP government has already extended the current tender by 3 years, thus giving more security to staff, and indeed will have the effect of having given time to CalMac to better prepare for its bid. I'm a lifelong trade unionist, so I do understand the importance of this debate to fellow trade unionists, many of whom are watching the debate just in the chamber today. I believe in the preservation of publicly owned ferry services, and it is something that our SNP government also supports. I want CalMac to succeed. Credit must also be given to our SNP Scottish Government for refusing to unbundle the routes, which would have allowed the private sector to cherry-pick the profitable ones, with the public sector being left picking up with the loss-makers. The Minister has also just offered to meet the Labour Transport spokesperson to discuss this matter further, to show his goodwill towards all involved in this debate. However, in the current tendering process, CalMac must sharpen their pencil and ensure we have the most efficient services possible. As an example of how they can do that, we only have to look at the new ferry proposals for the Mallaig Armidale service in my constituency. The new proposals initially look attractive because they offer an increase in capacity. However, there will be unintended consequences which will damage the local economy and reduce CalMac's income, thereby making it more difficult for them to compete with Serco. If CalMac is to compete with Serco, they must use their vessels as efficiently as possible and boost their income. But the current proposals for Mallaig Armidale will not do that. Yes, certainly.
Joanne Lamont. Would the member agree that CalMac has proven itself to be efficient, has delivered money back to the Scottish Government, while at the same time Serco, in various contracts, has shown itself to be far from adequate? Why would you even imagine that in that competition that, that it would be possible that you would want to give it to Serco, given their record?
Dave Thompson.
I'm pretty certain that CalMac will put in a very competitive bid and they will win this contract. That's what they need to do. The conditions are exactly the same for them and for Serco. Now, the problem with the current proposals for Mallaig Armidale is that the MV Lochinvar is much slower than the current ferry, the Carusc, and would have an increased journey time of 40 minutes. And there are no catering facilities for passengers. Also, potential reductions in Sunday sailings, just using the MV Lochinvar, may well lead to unacceptable 42% reductions in capacity, and this must be resisted. These changes will affect the economics of the route and CalMac's profitability, as well as damage the local economy. Of course, the Lochinvar will be supplemented by the Lord of the Isles during the week, which should provide 4 crossings each day when it is not sailing to and from Lough Boisdale. This would see it arriving in Mallaig at 10 a.m. and departing again to Lough Boisdale at 6:10 p.m. This means it will not be available for early morning coaches, which the Lochinvar will not have the capacity for, and on which many tourist businesses in Skye and West Lochaber rely. This will further undermine CalMac's ability to generate income on that route and compete with Serco, and will also further damage the local economy. The Mallaig Armidale crossing has in recent years been recognised internationally as one of the best ferry sailings in the world, and increasing numbers of tourists are using it. CalMac traffic statistics have seen a continual growth in vehicle and passenger numbers, which is set to increase dramatically this coming year following the introduction of road equivalent tariff, something my constituents and local CalMac employees are very grateful for. This will again add considerably to CalMac's income and their ability to compete with the private sector. The answer, of course, is to leave the Carusc where it is, supplemented by the Lord of the Isles, which would support the increase in traffic and therefore provide a boost to the economy and to CalMac's ability to compete with Serco. Further revenue increases could be achieved if the government commissioned a new vessel for the Oban to Craig Newer route, which is where the Carusc has been allocated to go. Whilst the new vessel is being built, possibly at Ferguson, so a win-win situation, an interim vessel can be chartered to increase capacity there. That would be a huge boost to the West Coast and something I would ask the Minister to consider very carefully.
Many thanks. We now turn to the closing speeches.
And I call on Tavish Scott, up to 7 minutes, please, Mr. Scott.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Rhoda Grant's voice may be breaking, but I totally understand the passion with which she made the case, as lots of members have across the chamber today. It was no different 10 years ago when lots of colleagues from all political parties expressed their concerns about shipping. I don't know what it is about shipping that gets us all up, but it's certainly relevant to this afternoon's contributions, and I want to recognise that right at the outset. I also want to just slightly take issue with the suggestion that everything run by the state is perfect. I'll go home on Friday and get on a ferry that is not run by CalMac, is not run by any government contract, it's run by our local authority at home in Shetland. And believe me, there are plenty of folk on the island I live on who are less than enamoured with that service. So I do think we need to at least have somewhat of a more open mind about the best way to configure really important lifeline services, whether they be shipping or otherwise. Seems to me, Presiding Officer, there have been two main points that the Labour motion today have raised, and rightly raised, in this in Parliament this afternoon. The first is, does tendering have to happen for the West Coast shipping services? Now, the onus is, of course, on the Minister of the Day to take the latest iterations of legal advice and have the government lawyers look at that and test that to destruction. Duncan McNeill made a fair point, and I'm sure Derek Mackay accepts that, that there is nothing to be lost and potentially something to be gained, although it is not wholly clear what that might be, from at least testing the legal opinions that have been quoted so extensively on the Labour benches today. Nothing to be lost by that at all, apart from some lawyers' time in Edinburgh. Well, we pay them plenty as it is. So I hope the Minister will at least accept that challenge. It seems to me to be fair. And I think successive ministers of different persuasions have always at least sought to consider that. That's what the pressure I was under from the SNP benches back in 2005. And we did test all those things to destruction. And I shared what I could at the time with opposition spokesmen. They didn't necessarily agree with it, but it seemed to me a reasonable way to do that. And I'm sure Mr. Mackay, who's a reasonable man, will at least explore that. And the second one, of course, follows from that. The second issue that David Stewart has rightly raised this afternoon flows from that, and that is if public procurement of the West Coast shipping services, just like the Northern Isles, is a requirement of EU law, then can the procedure, can the process itself protect the terms and conditions, the pension rights, the services, the other aspects that many members across the chamber this afternoon have rightly raised? Now, I completely recognise that reasonable points have been made, again, by a number of colleagues, including, if I may say so, particularly Joanne Lamont, about the difficulties, if I can express it in that way, of Serco. She and others were quite right to say that terms and conditions do and can and have changed, both in respect to the services that I depend on every day in my constituency. Of course, that was a contract let by this current government, and it is open to them to reconsider, and Mr. Mackay was making a point that he's had an independent procurement panel, reconsider how best to tighten that still further, which would recognise the entirely legitimate points that members on the well, on all benches have made this afternoon. And I hope, surely.
Minister.
I thank the member for giving way, and like Kim, I share his passion for all things to do with shipping, not least because of the strength of feeling which our respective constituents have in this. Would he likewise acknowledge, as he mentions pensions and conditions around that, the extent to which the Scottish Government has gone to ensure these are dealt with more successfully in this tender than in the last?
Tavish Scott.
Well, that, I suppose, will be the proof of the pudding will be in the eating. I hope Mr. Allen would accept that. And that is the concern that is there. And it will be for trade unions who have made their case to Parliament today in various ways to, I suspect, test that. But it is in the government's interests, I hope, to be able to be proved right on that. I think that is now their task. Can I just take up two or three points that have been made in the debate by particular members? Firstly, Duncan McNeill raised Gurek. I think I should say, in fairness to Duncan McNeill, not only was he right about the 200 jobs, but he resisted with some determination, a proposal back then when we had a relocation policy in Scotland, a relocation policy to take civil service jobs outside the Central Belt. cut, which I still think was the right policy. It's sadly been abandoned by the current government. Relocation policy to move the headquarters, I think, if I remember rightly, to Stornoway, which was very popular in Stornoway, but extremely unpopular in Gourock. And Duncan McNeill made the right arguments at that time, and that proposal went no further. And some of it was because of the arguments about the future of the tendering of the West Coast Ferry Services themselves. But I do absolutely recognise his point that every effort needs to be explored to see if there is a potential exemption from EU tendering rules. Personally, I don't see that happening, but I recognise the point that was made. The second point I wanted to pick up was from Joanne Lamont on bundling, or more accurately, bundling is a hell of a jargon word, but what she rightly was describing was allowing other ferry companies to cherry-pick the routes. If I can say on that, it just strikes me that the Scottish Government did have an option when they tendered the North Isles routes to take out Scrabster to Stromness, a point that Rob Gibson was making. No one in Orkney wanted that. I can't, of course, speak for Caithness, but I don't suppose it was particularly thought of in Caithness. So there is at least, therefore, a track record by successive governments, including the one that Joanne Lamont and I served in, of not allowing that unbundling, sorry, I've just used the word, of not allowing cherry-picking to take place. And I actually accept the Minister's arguments on this. I don't believe he believes that that cherry-picking would be good news for the west coast of Scotland, and I suspect on that we are all at one. The final point I wanted to make was just about the importance of making sure that this debate ultimately does concentrate on the service and on fares. And if I pick one issue I wouldn't agree with the government on, I believe that if you want to have a fair fares policy, just as we introduced again in the government that Joanne Lamont and I served on airfares, then if you're going to cut ferry fares by 55% on the West Coast, which is tremendously good news, I recognise, for Mr Allen's constituency, Mr Russell's constituency and others, and I welcome that. I think that's very supportive and a good thing for those West Coast island economies. Then you need to find a way to make sure that policy applies to other areas as well, because certainly Orkney and Shetland see no benefit of that approach. Road equivalent tariff does not work for us in the same way, but that doesn't mean you can't have a fair fares policy, which allows improvements to be made for the economies of those islands. And I hope in the round, the approach that the government will take will not just be about the vital issue of terms, conditions, of pensions and of the rights of the men and women who work for CalMac, but also about the fares and service that those of us who are islanders depend on.
Many thanks. I now call on Jamie McGregor. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I always welcome the opportunity to talk about the lifeline services that are so vital to the people of my region of the Highlands and Islands. I've used CalMac services myself for nearly 60 years, and I know the affection in which CalMac is held by many of my constituents. In today's Scotsman newspaper, there's an article on CalMac featuring Captain Norman Martin, known as Norwest Martin, who's retiring after 39 years' valuable service. He makes the point that CalMac is a private company owned by Scottish ministers. So I hope, of course, they'll be declaring an interest. And he also says that CalMac are delivering a difficult job to a great standard. And I think that sums it up pretty well. I would like to join other MSPs today in paying tribute to all the hard-working CalMac staff, who have helped consistently to ensure that CalMac's safety record is so impressive. Anyone who's travelled on those routes in high seas, thanks God that they're in a big boat. I can assure you of that. CalMac's safety record is so impressive, and they give our tourists such a warm welcome, which is another very good point. As others have pointed out today, I'm afraid Labour MSPs who are seeking to make political capital out of this current tender process are, I'm afraid to say, possibly guilty of serious double standards, because this SNP Scottish Government, by following EU law on the need to tender, is acting in exactly the same way as the then Lib Lab executive did when it tendered the current ferry contract. Of course, the SNP, then in opposition, acted in exactly the same way as Labour are doing now, criticising ministers for tendering. So we've got a reversal of roles, and round it goes. But the reality remains that were the Scottish Government simply to award ferry services to CalMac without a tender, it seems almost certain that the Scottish Government would fall foul of the European Commission's maritime cabotage regulations and be subject to legal challenge and likely defeat, with all the consequences associated with that. Certainly, yes.
David Stewart.
I mean, has the member read the QC's advice on this? This is what the whole emphasis behind our debate is. The TECL exemption is designed with Europe. It was an Italian case. It's happened in Britain through the Brent Council case. It is possible to do, but you just have to follow it through. The idea that you can't do it without seeking advice from Europe is a bit strange.
Jamie McGregor.
Well, I'm grateful to the member for that advice, but some seem to think otherwise. At the end of the day, all of us want to see the new CHFS tender ensure that we have the best possible level of ferry services for our island and coastal communities. And this is what we expect ministers to deliver through the tender process. The Scottish Conservatives are also very aware, not least in these times of real pressure on public spending, that ministers have a duty to ensure taxpayers' money is spent as wisely as possible. And this includes getting the best possible value for money from our publicly supported ferry services. Constituents in two parts of my region, namely Dunoon and Cowell and Orkney, are fortunate to have the option of using services provided by private ferry services, Western Ferries and Pentland Ferries, respectively, which are frequent, reliable and affordable. And I commend Western Ferries and Pentland Ferries and their employees for the excellent work they do without one penny piece of public subsidy, and would hope we can learn some lessons from these good practices. But there are a number of topical ferry issues within the CalMac network to which I wish to refer briefly. Dave Thompson talked about the concerns of our constituents in Lochaber and Skye and what they see as the unwarranted and very unwelcome plans to downgrade the Mallaig-Armidale service. I well remember some years ago joining the opening day sailing of the Corrisk, which was built, as far as I can remember, specifically for that route. And I share local concerns that it is to be downgraded to a lesser vessel of a smaller car capacity, which is also very much slower. I think it's 9 knots instead of 15. I'm asking the Minister to intervene on this and back the calls from the Slate Transport Forum for these plans to be reconsidered. Now, constituents in Campbelltown and Kintyre have asked me to press the Minister again to make an early decision on whether the Campbelltown to Arndrossan ferry service, which has been trialled now for 3 years, will be made permanent. There's significant community and business support for this service, which has the potential to provide Kintyre with a real economic boost. It's important we have an early decision so that local companies, including tourism enterprises, can plan ahead for next year. Constituents in Dunoon and Cowell have ongoing concerns about the reliability of the Argyll Ferries passengers-only service between Gourock and Dunoon, and ministers need to continue to monitor the performance of this service. I just want to say one more personal thing. I remember in the late 50s going to the island of Col and having to get out of the side of the Claymore, as it was, ship in those days, into an open ferry boat. This was crewed by Guy Jardine, John Allen, and Neely John McLean. All of these characters are portrayed in the famous Kirsty Morag books by Mary Hedwig. And I would have to say it was very hairy and very scary in those days, and I don't suppose health and safety would have liked it very much. But CalMac has moved on, and it is an efficient service, and I wish it well. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you. I now call on Derek Mackay, Minister, 8 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I begin on that note about appreciation of CalMac and its staff? Yes, I have the role as a determining minister in terms of the procurement exercise, but of course as sponsoring minister in terms of service provision. And I, of course, share all the positive comments around the staff and the services provided, but members have challenged me on making an early decision one way or the other, and of course I can't prejudice the outcome of this process. I actually think that members on all sides have been passionate, politically robust, but I think some consensus has emerged, and surely if we are genuine and altruistic about our motives, has to be appreciated, acknowledged, and then, of course, acted upon. I do believe that the legal advice and policy advice I've been given is robust, but if there is emerging new advice, of course it would be wrong to rule out even looking at that. And it's in that spirit that I agree to have a further meeting with the spokesman for the opposition to do that. I did it comprehensively. Note that the Labour members have appreciated that comment, and I say I think that's a very healthy environment that I can have an open and frank discussion on the advice. I did it comprehensively over the summer with the trade unions. Obviously, government can't share our legal opinion, but we can certainly test it and use the information that you have to challenge it so that I am continued to be convinced that we are conducting this necessary exercise, because if we didn't believe it was necessary, we wouldn't be embarking upon it. But it takes me back to a point that Tavish Scott has made, and what I thought was a very helpful speech in terms of the experience of a number of previous ministers, the advice that's been given, and our understanding of the European Commission position. And the EU, when challenged, has referred us back to the advice repeatedly that this is an exercise that we have to undertake. What I've done as Minister is not just say we'll embark on the exact same process, but actually look at process, look at the tendering exercise, look at the invitation to tender, look at the issues that we'll take into account to try and address a number of the concerns that many members have raised, with the exception of the Tories and Alec Johnson, who quite simply do want wholesale privatisation of public services. And apart from the Conservatives, no one else supports you on that, Mr Johnston. And we'll see what, through the spending review, is on the hit list for Tory privatisation today in Westminster. But in terms of the kind of decisions that I've been able to make to try and reflect the concerns, in terms of spending in our ferry services, it's massively increased. To reflect on the importance to island communities, when this administration entered office, the figure for 2007-08, just for the CHIFS network was £42 million, and this financial year, or the forecast for 15-16, will take the figure from £42 million to over £100 million. Substantial investment, as well as the vessels and the ports and harbours that members have discussed, as well as the implementation of RET. But this government is serious about the Fair Work Convention and those principles. And we are serious about protecting as best we can the interests of staff as well, which is why I engaged so extensively during the summer months. And in the words of the trade union, RMT and TSSA, they said that those unions believe we have reached the best possible deal achievable for our members, which will protect the current terms and conditions. And in so doing, we've also received written assurances from the Transport Minister that there will be a requirement by any successful bidder to provide current CalMac pension scheme. The pension scheme issue is important because the previous process just said a comparable scheme. I committed the government to the CalMac scheme, fair, transparent and reasonable. And yes, there are challenges within that pension scheme, but that's something we'll discuss by negotiation and a reasonable outcome. But the fact that there will be a CalMac scheme written in to this process should be reassuring, as well as a mechanism to ensure that any bidder can't simply go in and strip out costs and profiteer from that. There is a mechanism that disincentivises that kind of approach, and any discussions that will be had with the trade unions in terms of staffing levels. Another innovation was around the independent procurement reference panel to can I make some progress, because these points are very significant, that the independent procurement reference panel to ensure that the process is open and fair and transparent and their independent view that it was. Another significant change was around cost to quality. So I have moved that away from just cost analysis to quality, and the ratio is at 65% to 35%, a stronger emphasis on quality. No unbundling so that services can't be picked. And so I think these kind of decisions, as well as the investment decisions around our ferry services, show that this government's serious about the islands and, of course, public services. And on that note, I'll take David Stewart.
David Stewart.
I thank the Minister for his comments, and I certainly welcome his conciliatory approach and his wind-up, and I'll certainly be happy to meet to discuss this further. Just a very quick point on procurement. I mentioned in my speech that there's still three outstanding procurement directives which do help tackle, and just for the record, they're 2014, 23 to 25 EU. They haven't yet been incorporated in Scots law. If they're incorporated, Minister, which is in your power, it will help the tackle exemption greatly for this tender.
Minister?
I said in the spirit that the advice is offered, I'll take it, but the Cabinet Secretary, for example, in his discussions with European authorities this summer, it was re-emphasised that we need to undertake this process. So again, I'll look at your information and I'll be honest and transparent about what we can do, but I do believe that we have to undertake this process as per the timetable that's been outlined. I'll take a further intervention.
Minister, I'm only encouraging you to innovate one more time and let us know when the innovation of on the Campbellton service will be made permanent.
Minister.
Well, since two members have raised it, I'm waiting for advice. There will be an imminent decision, so I'll put a timescale on that of 2 weeks to make a decision and then share that with everyone concerned so I can come back to this debate. So with significant investment, with the consensual approach, I'll look at the advice, but the current exercise will continue in an open and a transparent way that inspires confidence from all involved, with the mechanisms that I've built in to try and protect the interests as best I can of staff and island communities. It shows we're serious about public services, serious about the issues that members have raised. And to be fair, two major points I think were acknowledged in this debate. The first, it was around the lifeline nature of these services, that no routes are actually under threat. That was acknowledged, I think, by the Chamber. And the other fair acknowledgement is there is no bias in favour of any one bidder. Therefore, those who said this was about handing it away to Serco, I think when challenged, and I don't know if Chick Brodie meant it or not, but when that question of bias was raised, the Chamber agreed there is no bias in favour of anyone. So we'll conduct this process competently in accordance with European law. We'll listen to the advice. I will continue to take the decisions that I think are right about enhancing services. And I have to make one party political point, if I may, whilst trying to keep with the consensual nature of the debate.
As long as you can make it well concluded, Minister.
It is difficult to take lectures from the Labour Party on privatisation when I think about PFI and the services that were handed over to the private sector. However, if this is a day of role reversal, let us work together on the issues that members have said concern them, that are important to island communities, and I give you that commitment as a Transport Minister and Minister responsible for the islands so to do in the most constructive way I possibly can. And I tell you, that will be continuing what I've been doing since my appointment about a year ago.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Sarah Boyack to wind up the debate. Ms Boyack, you have until 4:49. Sorry, 4:59.
I was thinking that was a pretty short speech. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I think this has been a very good debate, and I think there is acknowledgement that we have brought this debate to the Chamber because we believe there are issues that need to be properly tested. We firmly believe that the change in relation to TECL, the case law that follows from that, and the 2014 Procurement Directive do offer a new opportunity for the Scottish Government. And if I can seize on the comment by Duncan McNeill, the idea that we leave no stone unturned is one I can wholeheartedly agree with. This is about lifeline ferry services. It's about supporting the existence of our island communities who need our ferry services for food, supplies, for exports, for travel to work, for tourism. And as Joanne Lamont passionately argued, for the very existence of life in some of our remote rural and island communities. So these are crucial lifeline services. And those that work on our CalMac services deserve our praise and our thanks because they work in some of the toughest weather conditions anywhere in the world and they do it day in, day out. They deserve our thanks for that work. When I was the first ferry transport minister, that reality drove me because I was told in the early days that we couldn't have a single network. that we would have to unbundle it, as Tavish Scott avoided or tried to avoid saying, and that there would be the opportunity for cherry picking. And I argued at that point that these were lifeline services and we had to go back to Europe. We had to make the case to them to say that this was vital to all those communities and that if you began to unbundle those services, we could not provide those services and we knew that there would be islands which would not be served in the future. And to do that, to get the right to give public subsidy for one network, I had to win a battle. I had to take that battle with colleagues. I had to win support across the political spectrum. I did it in an open, transparent way with a Team Scotland approach to the EU to build consensus amongst MSP colleagues, to bring the UK government with us. I even did briefings for the MEPs because I wanted to test the difficult questions. I wanted to make sure I had gone every single mile that I could do to make sure that we won our case. And we did. We won that vital security and that future. There was no cherry picking. There was a cost-effective subsidy and, above all, a quality of service. Now, the job of any minister is to ensure that we have those services, the skilled and qualified and committed staff. That is vital to the delivery of the service as well. And that's why we've acknowledged the work of the members of those ferry unions. So we're holding this debate today because we have great concerns about the current tender process. We don't think that the current tender process, as is being carried, needs to be done because of the TECL exemption, because of the case law, and because of the change to procurement directive. And as Dave Stewart eloquently argued, the changes that are now set out in the 2014 procurement directive, we believe, have changed the game. We think they're extremely helpful. And if they're incorporated into Scots law, if the minister takes all those things together and he takes that case to Europe, we think there's a case that can be made. So I want to thank David Stewart for the work that he and the ferry unions and the STUC have been doing for months now. It is really hard work digging out those legal options. And giving us the opportunity, David himself has been to the EU Commission to test out what's possible. And that's why we came forward with our debate today. So I do welcome the Minister's commitment to meet with us. What we are calling on is for a pause in this whole process. Because a couple of the SNP backbenchers have said the clock is ticking. Well, actually, one of the lessons, you know, in the first few years of this Parliament is that while the clock does tick, there is always space. As long as you demonstrate to the Commission that we are serious about abiding by Commission rules, we merely want to ask, can we bring those rules together in a certain way? The Commission will not chase us if we are straight about that and if we are upfront about that. There is an issue about having our ferries that are influenced by the public sector. Yes, I'll take an intervention.
Do you remember, Greg?
Oh, I thank the member, esteemed member, for taking an intervention. When she was Transport Minister, I remember you promised us an integrated transport policy. I wondered how close to that dream you think we now are.
Well, if I had another half hour, I'd be more than happy to give you my view on that. The point is that we are now in a position where we can act. The difference between public sector and private sector ferry services is that there's clear accountability and direction. And that's one of the tests in TECL. If a company is owned, it's in the public sector. If it's clearly in the public sector, if there's clear accountability and direction from the public authority, then TECL can apply. And I think that's what we have with CalMac. And the legal opinion we had, very helpfully presented by RMT, needs to be addressed in full by the Scottish Government. The procurement directive also gives us an opportunity. Now, it's already been transposed by the rest of the UK. We need to get on with that as soon as possible in Scotland as well. Nicola Sturgeon made a commitment to the STUC conference in April and to the RMT representatives that CalMac would not be privatised. We clearly, across the chamber, have a difference of view on technically what means privatised. But many of us fear that if CalMac does not win this contract, there will be no CalMac, and the ferry services will have been privatised. And for those who laud the experience in the Northern Isles, well, I will just say that we have had reports of worries about ferry cancellations, about concerns about safety, about maintenance on the routes. And the chair of the Transport Partnership in the Shetland Isles has commented that there is now a groundswell of cynicism and resentment of the new services. He was willing to let it go for a year, but people are getting more and more disenchanted with the service. Ferries are always going to be controversial because it's about people's livelihoods. The attraction of it being directed by the Scottish Government, with the terms and conditions set and with a public sector company, is that they are accountable to all of us in this chamber, not just the ministers. And that is the point about CalMac. It is held in affection, it is loved, but in no way is it above criticism, as members have demonstrated across the chamber tonight. But it is accountable. And a key issue that I will want to raise with the Minister when we have a meeting is the issue about what happens to the 200 jobs in the HQ in Gourock. Duncan McNeill and also Mike Russell were right to point out the concerns that have been expressed, because Circle representatives have replied to questions from local communities that there will be no head office. Issues will be dealt with as they arise, and meetings will be held on local communities. So there are concerns about jobs, and after the first year, it will be possible for reorganisation by whoever wins the service. So I think we have a right to be fearful. And the comments that several members made, David Stewart and John Finney and Neil Bibby, highlighted the concerns people do have about Circle and the experience there have been with several public sector contracts. It takes an awful lot to be banned from providing a service by the UK government, especially one that is a Conservative government. We need to heed that warning. Rob Gibson suggested that within this Parliament, that time is of the essence. I think the key thing is we need to use our time wisely. We need to try and work together. We passionately believe there is a new option on the table. The RMT advice needs to be looked at. Neil Bibby's comments about it being highly significant were true. There is an issue about pursuing this issue to the nth degree. The detailed submission to the European Commission, we think that's what needs to be done now. If you listen to concerns across the chamber, there are serious questions that need to be answered, and the Scottish Government has powers which it needs to use. We are here to do our job as an opposition. We're not here as agents provocateurs. We're here to do the job of raising the issues our constituents bring to us. And the issues of ferry trade unions, the issues the STUC have brought to us, they need to be addressed by the Scottish Government. And that is the test of our job in this chamber, is to hold whoever the government is to account. And that has been the case in all the CalMac discussions we've had. That's our job tonight. We will do that. We welcome the Minister's offer to discuss with us, but we believe that this process should be delayed. As Mick Cash, the RMT's General Secretary, has said, the advice from a highly respected specialist source clearly demonstrates that the Scottish Government does not have to continue with the unnecessary and unpopular tendering of CalMac ferry services. We are therefore calling on the Scottish Government to stand up for Scotland and the communities that rely on those ferry line services and use its powers to apply the TECL exemption and also to cancel the tendering process forthwith. At the very least, they should carefully examine this advice and do what they have not done to date, which is to explore all options to cancel the tendering and keep CalMac public. This debate tonight has enabled us all to raise this issue. There would be no penalty to the Scottish Government for delaying the process or for cancelling the process. We will meet with the Minister. We will leave no stone unturned. We will do the job of the opposition, which is to make sure that the people who live in our islands and our rural communities and the people who work on those lifeline ferry services have every effort made to defend their position, to defend those lifeline services on which jobs and rural communities' lives depend. That is the test that we need to live up to as a Scottish Parliament. Our motion today is a vehicle to bring that about. I hope members will set aside their party interests and support our motion tonight. It is the way forward, it's constructive, and it will do the job that our island communities need.
Thank you. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 14959 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a revision to the business programme for Thursday, 26 November. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 14959. No member is asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the chamber. The question is that motion number 14959 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 14945 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 14945.
Moved.
No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the chamber. The question is that motion number 14945 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of a Parliamentary Bureau motion. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 14948 on approval of an SSI. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now.
Moved.
Mr Finney has indicated he wishes to speak against the motion, so I now call on Mr Finney. Mr Finney, you've got up to 3 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This order relates to the International Organisation's Immunities and Privileges, and the request is that they apply to an organisation called the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. We're told that the privileges and immunities relate to protect the independent exercise of their functions. Now, one might reasonably ask what functions require a criminal immunity. We're told that this will also provide a level playing field and with regard to the operation of this bank, but the level playing field that I would certainly want to see is a level playing field where everyone adheres to the law. We're also told that the purpose of this would be so that the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank would be free from undue influence in their affairs. That apparently is the requirement to adhere to the law of Scotland and indeed pay taxes in Scotland. There are two groups of who will benefit from this. There's the organisation, and the organisation will benefit from immunity from suit and legal process, inviolability of its archives and premises, relief from non-domestic rates, exemption from devolved and local taxes, and exemption from prohibition and restrictions on imports and exports. The other group who will benefit are individuals, and they are termed as staff, and I quote, experts on a mission. And they will be immune from suit and legal process in respect of, and also exemption from devolved and local tax. This request, Presiding Officer, isn't coming from a business person. It's not directly coming from the UK government. It's coming from the... No. It's coming from the... Well, yes, I'll take an intervention.
As the member knows, the Justice Committee reported on this and by 8-1 voted in favour of this going forward.
Mr Finney?
Yes, I'm grateful for that piece of information I was aware of. This request does not come from a business person. It does not come directly from the UK government. It comes by the Cabinet Secretary for Justice. Now, many people might reasonably anticipate the Cabinet Secretary Justice would come to the Justice Committee extolling people to adhere to the law of the land. And indeed, I asked him what sort of approach he would take if an individual or a business approached him saying that they wish to transact business from him so long as they would grant him immunity from criminal prosecution. It's very clear that this is intended to be business as usual, but it's not the new politics that I understood this building to be wanting to follow. So I would encourage everyone to vote for everyone in Scotland adhering to the law of the land and paying taxes, and I thank you very much. Yes, well, I'm
sorry, you are concluding, Mr Finney.
Okay,
can I call on Michael Matheson to respond, Cabinet Secretary, up to 3 minutes?
Presiding Officer, this order would confer legal immunities and privileges on or in connection with a new international organisation, the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. The Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank is not an ordinary bank. It is a specific kind of international organisation known as a multilateral development bank. The purpose of this organisation is to provide finance and advice to address the gap in investment in infrastructure in Asia. The UK Government has signed an international agreement which provides the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank with privileges and immunities in all states which become members. States which are members range from Iceland to Germany. Some privileges and immunities relate to reserved matters and have been conferred by the Westminster process. The equivalent Westminster order was approved by both Houses of Parliament without opposition and by the Privy Council on the 11th of November. As some privileges and immunities relate to devolved matters, this order would add this new body to a list of organisations with similar privileges and immunities in Scotland. That list is in the Schedule of International Organisations Order 2009. The schedule includes bodies such as International Maritime Organisation and the European Police College. Privileges and immunities were also granted pre-devolution to other
multilateral development banks like the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, which has a similar function. Privileges and immunities are commonly granted to international organisations. Under international law, those entitled to diplomatic immunity are expected to obey the law of their host state. Let me be clear. This organisation and its officials will be expected to comply with the laws of this country. Membership of the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank provides considerable opportunity for those working in the financial and professional services sector in Scotland. These sectors employ almost 100,000 people directly and around the same number indirectly. Scottish companies already have a strong background in these fields. If Scottish businesses are to be able to take advantage of the potential work which UK's membership of the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank might generate, then this order is necessary. This order was considered by the Justice Committee, which recommended that the Parliament approve it, and I would call upon Parliament to approve it this evening.
Thank you. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of two Parliamentary Bureau motions. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 14946 on a committee remit and motion number 14947 on the designation of a lead committee. The questions on these motions will be put at decision time, to which we now come. There are seven questions to be put as a result of today's business. Can I remind members that in relation to the debate on Keep CalMac Public, if the amendment in the name of Derek Mackay is agreed, the amendment in the name of Tavish Scott falls. The first question is amendment number 14942.3 in the name of Derek Mackay, which seeks to amend motion number 14942 in the name of David Stewart on Keep CalMac Public be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote, amendment number 14942.3 in the name of Derek Mackay is as follows. Yes, 60. No, 41. There were 13 abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed to, and the amendment in the name of Tavish Scott falls. Can I remind members? The next question then is amendment number 14942.1 in the name of Alex Johnson, which seeks to amend motion number 14942 in the name of David Stewart and Keep CalMac Public be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament's not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 14942.1 in the name of Alex Johnson is as follows. Yes, 13. No, 101. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14942 in the name of David Stewart as amended on Keep CalMac Public be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion number 14942 in the name of David Stewart as amended is as follows. Yes, 65. No, 36. There were 13 abstentions. The motion, as amended, is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14948, in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, on approval of an SSI be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The Parliament has not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote of motion number 14948 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick is as follows. Yes, 109. No, 5. There were no abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14946 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on a committee be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14947 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on the designation of a lead committee be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We now move to members' business. Members who leave the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.
Moving swiftly.